satyam param dhimahi. Om satyam param dhimahi. Om satyam param dhimahi. Om satyam param dhimahi. Om satyam param dhimahi.
So Wednesday we'll take my guru's notes on the universal mind and subjective mind. I hope I've not taken it before. Sure? Okay. So today, last year we talked about pride and vanity, but just to give us a kind of refresher, what we have to observe, how will we differentiate the two? Pride, garv, abhiman, vanity, also abhiman, atva mithya abhiman, pride and vanity. Now in life, we go through many shocks, and the greatest shock of all is death. Right? And every time somebody close to us dies, it is a shock. Because with that someone dying, something in us dies too. There is an intermingling of energies between people. There's an intermingling of prana. And when somebody whom we have related to for a very long period of time dies, then there is a gap inside, because when he dies, he takes his prana with him. And that prana which had intermingled with our prana leaves a gap inside. It leaves an empty space inside. So not only, we have of course many other shocks in life. Like there could be business losses, there could be loss of love, etc. But the greatest shock is the shock of death. Most of us, whenever somebody very close dies, are so identified with the event that we don't use that event for a real jump in our inner consciousness. So, this empty space which is created in all of us, and it lasts for a very little time, because within a few days we just start taking everything for granted again. We go back to our old dull routine, right? The same habits of life, the same sleep of life. Right? And the shock which came, the shock which could have been utilized for something higher, we wasted it. So can we sense death? Can we think about death every day? Can that thinking about death, the realization of the shock of death, can it help us to think in a new way? Can it help us to relate to life in a new way? I was just looking at Facebook today, and a good friend of mine, a school friend of mine, he collects vintage cars, and he's put it on Facebook, some 1927 Mercedes, my new baby. I'm wondering, here we are going on 60. Death is round the corner. And my new baby, 1927 Mercedes. stupid can man be? How stupid can man be? Man was born to realize such higher potentialities. And he's stuck with collecting toys. Doesn't grow up. He collects vintage cars. Just a child. The body has grown. The intelligence is just the childish intelligence. So, try to think of death every day. Death is the greatest moment in life. It is the most beautiful moment of life. And we don't want to miss it. And every time somebody close to us dies, practice for that moment in life. It is a shock. Make use of that shock. But we keep going back to our old ways, and I don't blame life. The pace and the noise of modern life is so fast. Maybe in South Africa it's faster, I don't know. At least I've seen one thing in the last few days. The flies here are faster than the flies are in India. There's something in the water over here. They're so good, you can't catch them, you know, the flies over here. In India, they're lazy flies. The water is definitely different over here. So the noise of modern life, it pulls us back, the pace of modern life. And life today has, science has invented so many ways to seduce our senses. So many ways of keeping our attention indulged in the appetites of the senses. And so we get this shock. Somebody dies and in a few days we are back to normal life. Let's go to McDonald's today, let's do this today. And the shock, no real use of the shock has been done. We are again running to have all our desires fulfilled. We didn't realize the shock. That shock came for a certain reason in our life, that desires cannot be fulfilled. It's not possible. And we woke up a little also. We were a little shocked. There was grief inside of us. The attachment had broken. But the attachment to desire does not break. And the only way we can know this is through self-observation. This is the key to separate inside between I and it, to start observing it. What is it doing? How is it having breakfast? What thoughts when he's having breakfast, what thoughts are passing through it? What emotions are passing through it? But this takes time. This takes effort, this takes energy, it takes application, it takes attention, right? And after some time, we just cannot maintain the momentum. And in many places I see that people who don't know, they pretend that they know. Now, once we start pretending that we know, then everything is very dangerous. We have entered into very dangerous territory. We now have a picture of ourselves, the picture that I know. And at any cost, now we have to hold this picture. At any cost, we must save this picture. At any cost, we must justify this picture, defend this picture. I know. And once we start pretending in life, then there can be no real direction, no real development in life. The Bible speaks a lot of casting out of the devils. Cast out the devil from yourself. The casting out of the pictures we have made of ourselves, they are the biggest devils within us. Asuri Shakti. Jetla under Chitra Bheda Kera. The devils within us. Pictures hinder every new experience. We cannot experience anything higher if we are stuck to a picture that I know, that I am good, I am so kind, I am such a generous person. If we are stuck to all these pictures which we have collected in our album, we can never rise in life. We'll be stuck. The gravitation of the pictures will keep on holding us to the ground. We think one big slab of concrete is very heavy. Nothing can grow under that slab. Right? And we have these pictures of ourselves, and the pictures are made out of imagination. All pictures are made out of imagination. And they are controlled by something called vanity. It is these two things which go together, vanity and imagination. They weave, they create all these pictures. And our general idea about imagination, that it is something airy, something misty, something that is subtle, which goes on in the mind. Something which is of the subliminal region. But we don't realize that imagination is more powerful than concrete. It is more heavy than concrete. We think it is airy, but it is real. Pictures are fixed forms of imagination. And they are created by something called vanity. Vanity means mithya abhiman. A vanity abaddhi chitra apni andar banaya chhe. And a chitra concrete karta hai majboot chhe. Mara guru ghani vaar kehta ke tamara sanskar je chhe ne e lokhandni plate karta hai majboot. Lokhandi plate truth se bata sanskar nahi hai. The memory patterns inside, they are stronger than a metal plate. Vanity is the most powerful and terrible force in us. And imagination is its slave. Vanity is the builder, and imagination is the mason who puts brick by brick and creates all the pictures inside. And once the picture is made, we are stuck with the picture, attached to the picture. We don't realize that this is a picture. Every moment we are living a picture. Every moment in our life. Then nothing new can happen in our life. No new feelings, no new ideas, no new meaning. And we never see vanity. Ye je mithya abhiman che ne apne joi j nahi sakta. Etla chotela che nahi sakta. We cannot see it. So we never know that we are living in a picture. Nothing real. We see the results of vanity. We don't see vanity itself. And it is these results of vanity which we must study. And everything can be created into a picture. If I become a disciple, then I'll have a picture of myself as a disciple. Of how good a disciple I am. And I remember when, you know, all the disciples collect to the guru, some people would ask me, is my love as good as Meera's love now? What are you trying to say? And the very idea of love is that you're free of comparison. If there is comparison, there's no love. And they're comparing their love. So we cannot see vanity, but we see the results of vanity. When we are insulted, we see the results of vanity. When we feel other people are taking us for granted, we see the results of vanity. Many women have midlife crisis. They come and they say, oh, now I'm 55 years old. For my whole life, I did for my husband, I did for my children. Now I want to do for myself. Everything is a business. No? Everything is a calculation. So, we feel we are taken for granted. And especially this crisis comes if the son gets married. Because now his attention from the mother goes to the daughter-in-law. And then the midlife crisis starts. Then the emptiness starts, taken for granted. We feel we are not appreciated properly. We don't want others to take us for granted. We feel insulted. We feel not appreciated when others take us for granted. But we don't realize that every moment we are taking ourselves for granted. We think we are human beings. We think we are men. While we are nothing but just animal passion put together. We take that for granted. So wherever there is vanity, wherever we are in vain, we are having a picture of ourselves, we have a high opinion of ourselves, of how good we look, of how skillful we are, of how many abilities we have. And none of us ever think that we are in this, what do you call, arrogance, or in this vanity, in this arrogance, in this self-conceitedness. None of us ever realize it. Others can see it. We don't realize it. This dominating picture. And we keep on serving and feeding that picture. Can you see it is a kind of slavery? It is a slavery to an inner picture. Andar chitra bani kuchhe, abhiman. અને એ ચિત્રના આપણે ગુલામ બની ગયા છે. The pictures are so close, we are so attached to the picture, it's very difficult to observe it. So all of us, without exception, all of us, within ourselves, we have two contradictory sides. And if we can observe these two sides, if we can see all these two sides together, both of them, then we will see how we have deceived ourselves over the years. How our vanity plays tricks with us. How our vanity has fooled us. All the lies we have spoken to hold that picture of vanity. That false side of us, so much of lying we have to do just to hold on to that picture. So many tricks we played. So, ये चित्र ने पकड़वा माटे वर्षों सुधी कितलो आपने जुठानो के ये आपने देखा से. We are always defending this picture, and of course, the lawyers inside are much better than the Supreme Court. They can defend anything, the lawyers inside. How we always seek excuses for what we have done. For our reactions, for the way we speak, for the way we relate. How we keep on excusing ourselves. And we don't say that I want to be free of this sleep, this identification with life. Can you just see our relationship to others? Supposing one person comes to class every day, and he's making some excuses. I know, because when we were in school, there was one guy in our class who would always bump the PT class. And the next day the PT master would be looking for him. And he would come, and he had a beautiful way of saying it. But sir, I came yesterday, no sir. But I'll come again tomorrow, no sir. And he had such a beautiful way of saying it. By the time he was finished, the sir would be helpless. Get rid of this guy. So if the person is making the same excuses every day, we get tired of that person, we get bored of that person, we get sick of that person. And we don't see that our vanity is making the same excuses every day. Study married life, it's so easy. Just you have to study your own married life. 20, 30 years of married life. And you will see how you did something, again made an excuse, again did something, again made an excuse, and in so many things, and in so many things. Oh, I was held up in traffic. Oh, I was late today. Will a sandwich do? And then we realize that this vanity of ours, it's been playing tricks with us. So when we become sick of our own excuses, then understand that our self-observation has now gone a little deep. Now we are not sick of somebody else making an excuse. We are sick of that person inside who's repeating the same thing day in and day out. Then we won't justify it, because that very sickness has given us a new taste of that inner vanity. Now we don't like that vanity. We hate that vanity. And suddenly we realize that if we were to meet ourselves on the road somewhere, we would run away. We wouldn't make a friend of this person. We'll be sick with what we are. And this is a very, very important point in our journey. This is the turning point in our journey. When we are sick, not with others, but sick with ourselves. That is a very important point. Then we'll fall down into the chariot and we'll throw down the weapons and say, okay, we don't want to fight. That is Vishad. And that Vishad will then transform into yoga. But it has to happen. So our understanding of self-observation now is no longer just intellectual. It has risen to a different level. We will suddenly see that we have a whole album of pictures. And each picture takes what you call, it dominates us at different times. At different times, a different picture is holding us in slavery. They keep on making us believe what we are not. We live in this make-believe world, what we are not. Observe your own self. You see somebody, you're walking in the garden or you're sitting somewhere and you see somebody entering the room or you see somebody walking from far away. And you suddenly see you know that person. Now observe the vanity coming in, the false coming in, how the way you walk changes, how the expressions on the face change. Right. Try to see how we make a sort of impression on that person of how important we are, right. How we smile at him or her, how much interest we calculate, how much interest we want to show, how much interest we don't want to show. How we look around to see if anybody else is watching. All this is that false guy has taken charge. The picture has taken charge of us. And initially it will be difficult, but then suddenly we'll see in that observing how the way we talk changes. How the way we pronounce our words change. we are totally in the power of a picture. Behind all these pictures is the real person. The real person. It's not very far away. He's just a little behind. E.J. Gold, he talks of something called the chronic. And it's very beautiful. He says that there is something in all of us. And at certain moments of observation, we are on the verge of rising into something which is very high. But at that time, that chronic comes and takes over and we fall down. Okay. It is just waiting. It is just waiting over there. And we don't see it. We can't see it. It only comes at a time when we are on the point of being detached with everything and being elevated into a more beautiful or a higher state. And at that time that chronic comes. And it's just waiting over there. And even if the state comes, it will eat it up. It will take away the state. And so we have to, we observe, we get glimpses, but at the moment of getting a glimpse, we have to see what comes out of our vanity to stop us at that time. And Gurdjieff calls this the chief feature. My guru used to call it the chief weakness. And all of us have a deep down weakness inside. Story is very beautiful that Indra could not stand that Vishwamitra was rising to such a high level. And Indra is the lord of the senses, Indriyo, the lord of the senses. And when a person detaches from the senses, then he is not in command of the senses, then he doesn't indulge in life any longer. If the king feels that something is going out of his kingdom, so he sends something. And he understands this language of the chronic, the chief weakness. He understands this language properly. So he arranged a full, he called Venka and said, you have to go and disturb this. And she refused. Indra was her king, she refused. She said, how can I go and disturb his meditation? If he looks at me, I'll become ashes. He's so powerful. If he opens his eyes and look at me, I'll be burned to ashes. But Indra says, no, you have to go. And then he says, okay, I'll ask the wind god to help us. And the wind god will come and he will make all the fragrances of the flowers so powerful at that time. And you will wear a thin cloth and you will be dancing in front. And just when his eyes open, the wind god will come and take away your cloth. This is the chronic. And Vishwamitra got caught. He got caught and it went into a long sequence. He married Menka and he had a child. And when the child was born, suddenly he woke up. Oh, where have I gone? Don't take all this literally. Otherwise, you'll start practicing in your married life. It's all symbolic. Symbolic. The child was Shakuntala. Shakuntala. Right? So, this chronic is waiting there. It's just waiting. At the moment when it feels we are going to realize, it plays some trick on us. And it is very clever. Next time it's not going to play the same trick, it will come in some other form. So we must recognize it. And Gold has written very beautifully that if you recognize it, be free of it in 3 months, otherwise in 3 months it will change its colors, you will never recognize it again. So important. So behind all these pictures is the real person. And And it is that real person whom we are in search of. But we live in the imagination of pictures. And we meet each other. All our relationships are not real relationships. They are meeting of one imagination with another imagination. The person who is meeting us is also in a picture. When we go to meet that person, we are also in a picture. When we fall in love with somebody, we are in a picture. She is also in a picture. It's two pictures falling in love. How can that love last? This is the basic cause for all our misery. All the tensions of ordinary life, all the tensions, whether on the scale of the life of the whole world. And it is due to something formed very early in our age, and that is vanity. It is formed at a very young age, and it cannot be helped because the baby is the center of attention. Everybody is running for the baby. So the baby thinks that I am the king, I am the emperor. Nothing can be done about it. The vanity is formed in the baby. If we could be free of vanity, we would realize it is the cause of all the violence in the world. Vanity. When can we be free? Supposing this moment we wanted to be free, how would we be free? If we were the last living human being on the earth, would there be vanity? Or if we were lost on some island, would we have vanity? No vanity. That very moment all the vanity would drop. But as long as we relate with the other, there is vanity. And that's why it's very important to see ourselves through the eyes of relationship. So, something is formed at a very early age, vanity and self-conceit. These are just an exaggerated opinion of what we think ourselves to be, of our qualities, of our abilities. We can only reach self-consciousness if vanity and self-conceit drop. We cannot carry them with us. Both are not possible. If there is vanity, then we cannot stay in that third state of consciousness. We talked of the four states of consciousness: Sushupti, Swapna, Jagruti, Turiya. That third state, Jagruti. We cannot stay in that state. We cannot take vanity together in that state. We have to drop it before entering that state. Try to see that inner tension, how much we have to lie, how much wrong we have to do just to maintain this picture which we have of ourselves. Pride and vanity, they are two giants. Pride and vanity, two giants. They walk in front of us. They are 10 feet ahead of us. And they are always arranging everything. Always arranging everything. So, one of the things of self-observation, first we went into self-love, and from self-love comes vanity, is to observe vanity. We must study pride and vanity. And both are connected with self-love. Now, sometimes both will move together, sometimes both will move in opposite directions. And this is where we study them. Right? Sometimes one will oppose the other, they will move against each other. Right? So this is where we recognize that this is pride and this is vanity. Right? Somebody pays us a compliment, somebody praises us. That part of us inside which feels awkward is pride. And that part of us which takes delight in the praise, which enjoys the praise, is vanity. This is how we divide. કે કોઈક આપણા વખાણ કરે, કોઈક બે શબ્દ આપણા માટે સારું બોલે, તો અંદર આપણી અંદર જે ભાગને શરમ આવે છે, જેને આમ ગમતું નથી, એ ગર્વ છે, પ્રાઇડ છે. પણ જે ભાગને એમાં રસ પડે છે અને આનંદ આવે છે, એ મિથ્યા અભિમાન, અભિમાન છે, વેનિટી. This is how we have to recognize both of them within us. Now, if they are both working together, આપણને શરમ જ નથી આવતી, વી ડોન્ટ ફીલ ઓકવર્ડ ઇનસાઇડ વેન સમબડી પેઝ અ કોમ્પ્લિમેન્ટ, ધેટ ઇઝ ઓનલી વેનિટી, ઓનલી વેનિટી, રાઈટ? પ્રાઇડ હેઝ સમથિંગ ઓફ વેલ્યુ. પ્રાઇડમાં હજી કંઈક વેલ્યુએબલ છે, પણ વેનિટી ઇઝ ટોટલી ઇમેજિનરી એન્ડ ધ મોસ્ટ અનરિયલ પાર્ટ ઓફ અસ. It belongs to false personality. Pride can belong to false personality, can belong to personality, and it can also touch essence. And later on we will see how pride merges with real will. Pride merges with real will. Pride can become a part of our will and then it enters into essence. Using pride, we can live a more rich life. We can work better. We can endure other people's negativity better. We can bring more patience in our lives. Pride can be used if it is used positively. કોઈ આપણું અપમાન કરે તો સહન કરવાની શક્તિ એ ગર્ભમાંથી આવી શકે. અંદર ઉતાવળ હોય પણ અંદર ધીરજની શક્તિ એ આપણને ગર્વ આપી શકે. તો પ્રાઇડ, ઇફ ઇટ ઇઝ યુઝ્ડ ઇન ધ રાઇટ વે, કેન બીકમ અ પાવરફુલ ફોર્સ એન્ડ વન ડે ઇટ વિલ ચેન્જ ઇન ટુ રિયલ વિલ. બીકોઝ દે મૂવ અગેન્સ્ટ ઈચ અધર, વિથ ઈચ અધર, રાઇટ, મર્જ વિથ ઈચ અધર, ઇટ ઇઝ સમટાઈમ્સ વેરી ડિફિકલ્ટ ટુ ડિસાઇડ વાય વી ડીડ સમથિંગ ઇન અ life. Why did I buy a new set of clothes? Why did I buy a new car? Why did I choose this house? Did I do it from pride or did I do it from vanity? And after long self-observation, will we be able to decide the difference between us? See, every decision we take in our life, we have to see where is the pride, where is the vanity. From buying small things like shoes, where is the pride, where is the vanity? When you're buying your laptop and if suddenly it comes, if somebody sees this laptop and is going to say something, understand, it's immediately it's vanity. So you it's, and then all these thoughts do come, don't say they don't come, they do come, right? And it is in that we decide that in this decision of mine, how much the role is played by vanity and how much of the role is played by pride. But vanity has a very different taste about it. It was mithya abhiman no swad pakadega. Once we've caught it properly, then we know what it is. Then the taste is different. It is always connected with making an impression upon people. There is always the other in vanity. It is always connected. I want to make an impression. And we have to be very careful, very, very careful. I have seen so many times with the guru, so many times in so many gurus, that many times students are asking the same question out of vanity. This question is the same. But have I asked it? And I'm looking at whether people are looking at me when I ask the question, then it is out of vanity. And I've asked it for my own work, then it is out of pride. Question can be the same question. So what was the motive behind? What lies behind? Even when we are preparing a speech, supposing I'm writing this speech, and I'm thinking of what effect it has upon you, then vanity has come in. So even in the writing of a small talk like this, how much of part is played by my will and how much of part is played by vanity? What is the motivating force? If it is vanity, then it is false. The motivating force is false. Vanity always needs an audience. Shrotagan joye. Even, and this does not mean that other people have to be there. We may be in a room all alone, but imagining how we are, other people are reacting to us, then it is vanity. If we were the only person left on the earth, no, vanity, but pride would still be there. Pride would still be there. So vanity, now many times we have a vanity of our looks, right? But that doesn't mean that people who don't look good don't have vanity. People who may not have beautiful looks also have vanity. And the most famous is what we call is Alexander Pope. All his friends, everybody, he's the third most quoted person in English literature. Third most quoted person in English literature. First is Shakespeare, second is Tennyson, and third is Alexander Pope. Right? But all his friends and everybody knew him to be a very, very vain and full of vanity, and it was very difficult to become friendly with Pope. And he was a hunchback, very ugly, because when he was young he got TB and all his bones were deformed. And he rose to be one of the greatest poets ever. And not only one of the greatest, but one of the richest poets also. And he had this vain thing about it. So, and he had, his vanity came from the way he could talk in humor, the way he could talk in satire. Right? The wit, he had a big vanity about his wit. Now this is a very dangerous form of vanity, when we can make other people laugh. It's a very, very dangerous form of vanity. Because then those people get so, hypnotized by other people's attention that they can never transform themselves. And this we see with all those people come on TV who are great artists in making other people laugh. Their only interest in life is how to make the other laugh. There can never be self-observation. They are very good other observation. They observe life very well and take small situations in life and make you laugh out of it. And there are so many of them. In India, here also, West also. Very good, but they cannot observe themselves because they are always observing situations of life outside. So he had this vanity about his own humor and his own satire, Alexander Pope. He was an ugly hunchback, but was vain in his literary wit and position. Now, this is another place where we can catch both pride and vanity, because in many instances in life, vanity wants to show off, but pride feels a shame in showing off. એટલે વેનિટીને દેખાડો કરવાની અંદરથી ઉત્સુકતા થાય, પણ અંદરથી પ્રાઇડને શરમ આવે કે આ દેખાડો કરવો. તો બંનેને અલગ આપણે જોઈ શકીએ. સમવન આસ્ક્સ અ ક્વેશ્ચન એન્ડ ઇફ વી ડોન્ટ નો ધ આન્સર, ધેન પ્રાઇડ વિલ સે આઈ ડોન્ટ નો ધ આન્સર, બટ vanity will pretend to know everything about the question. Pride will feel ashamed. Then sharam avse ke mane jawab avarto nathi. Vanity never feels ashamed. A vanity can never feel ashamed. That is, vanity always defends, always self-justifies. I may be defending myself. justifying my wrongdoings. Pride will never do it. Vanity always justifies. Pride has a different look from vanity. In pride we blush. In vanity we are haughty. So both have different looks. Pride ma apno color badlai jaye, andar sharam se jaye. Vanity ma apno aham bahar aave. And banne no suke look banne ni chitra alag chhe. Pride can go inside, it can turn inward, it can be outward also and inward also. Vanity can only be outward. But if pride is going outward, then it can become a friend of vanity. Then it works with vanity. When pride is turned inward, it brings a special shame in our lives, which is very, very important. Special shame in our life. And that shame is when we forget our aim. We forget our aim and we react. And immediately we become aware, and pride brings a kind of shame. Ramdulai Bapu has said this so beautifully, that final experience of truth, and he has taken pride right up to there, that final experience of truth. He says in his small book, Baat kahun to baat jaati hai, chup rahun to ye raat jaati hai. तेरे दरवाजे तक तो आ पहुंचा हूं, आगे मुझे शर्म आती है. Now there is no vanity. If I speak, then I'm just speaking. If I don't speak, then this night is going to pass away. I've come to your doorstep, but now to open the door, I'm feeling a little ashamed. Because I still have pride, but there is no vanity, and that pride is making me feel a little ashamed. I don't want to open the final door. So beautifully he has put it. So if we forget our aim and a certain shame comes inside, a feeling of being ashamed, I forgot my aim. My aim was to rise in life, not to react, not to express negativity. Okay, it happened. And then we are now moving on this path of self-observation. This shame has come. Vanity is never concerned with the deeper and higher aspects of life. But it will show that it is very much concerned about it. And this is the beauty of vanity. Pride can be concerned with the real, the more inner, the more permanent things in life. If someone hurts vanity, someone insults vanity, it makes one angry, it makes one offended. Andar mathu lage che, jyare apna vanity ni upar koi patro phenke che, mathu lage che. We want to react. But in pride, we may feel ashamed to react. There will be a kind of shame, I don't want to react. So in our role in life, whatever role we are playing in life, whatever profession we are doing in life, we have to see whether we are doing it out of vanity or whether we are doing it out of pride. If there's pride in the way I play my profession, then I will enjoy it. There'll be deep joy in doing my work. But if there's vanity, then I'm always bothered about what picture am I coming off on other people. When somebody criticizes us, pride may not like the criticism, but it will accept the criticism. And if there is a little consciousness, little self-observation inside, it will immediately transform the criticism and make use of the criticism. In vanity, there will be deep resentment, deep anugamo, of the criticism. And he loudly rejected and fight with the person also. Vanity loves to sing its own song. Potana vakhan karu bhogam. Vanity likes to blow its own trumpet. Pride remains a silent spectator. If we could observe our pride, if we can separate our pride from vanity, then we can make real creative use, constructive use of our pride. Pride properly directed inside can lead us to a feeling of nothingness. When we just sense our place in the universe, what on this relative scale of the universe, what position am I occupying? Even if we sense in the solar system, our earth is nothing but a dot. It's just a small cell of this whole galaxy in which we are in. And in that small galaxy, how much space do we occupy? So, if proper use of pride, then we can realize in this whole relativity of this whole universe, we are nothing. And that feeling of nothingness is a beautiful feeling. It is more deeper than falling in love with someone. Pride is not so subject to the law of the pendulum. Vanity can move from one extreme to another extreme. Now, another giant in us is laziness. And laziness is of three forms: intellectual laziness, emotional laziness, and moving central laziness. Three kinds of laziness. Mad is intoxication, pramad, intoxication of my knowledge, intoxication of my who I am. That's intellectual laziness. Emotional laziness, alasya, emotional laziness. I don't feel like relating one. So this is a big giant in us, laziness. And we have to work with it. Now, if we have observed pride in us, and if we have made constructive use of pride, then pride will never allow us to become a slave of laziness. And this is the beauty of pride, because many people come to me and ask, what to do about laziness? We don't feel like doing it. We don't feel like, and you see, emotional laziness, I don't feel like doing it. They don't have pride. And if they can take pride in doing it, then that pride can overcome laziness. Vanity cannot overcome laziness. Vanity will do something which will take care of everything, both together. It will make some samjota, arrangement with laziness. Right? So, in pride, it will wake me up from the bed and I'll do all the exercises. But vanity will come and it'll say, okay, we don't have time, let's do half minute each exercise. So, it is made a samjota, you know, an understanding with. And this is typical vanity. Right? But pride is something totally different. Then there is another giant in us called fear. Right? Vanity always will boast how it never feels fear. Pride will feel shame and will look at ways of being free of fear. How do I rise above fear? Emotional fear. Instinctive fear. How do I rise above them? How much of instinctive fear do I have to hold on to? Just necessary for the preservation of life. Can I be free of all the other fears? Psychological fear, imaginative fear. Worry is imaginative fear. Negative imagination. All these fears. So, these are just some thoughts on studying pride and vanity in us. Please see that vanity loves everything that feeds it, gratifies it. Jya jya tere khorak mare. So we love our neighbors, we love our friends, only if they gratify us, only if they feed our vanity, only if they flatter us. Supposing we were to make a drawing of a person full of vanity, what kind of drawing would we make? Full of self-love, full of big estimation of himself, full of that value which he thinks he's such a worthy human being, self-worthiness, whose only interest is himself, whose only interest is self-excitement. What will excite him today? If we can make a picture, if we can make a psychological picture of that. This is what Christ calls a rich man. He is a rich man. Right? And this has been this big thing in the Bible, because and Jesus looked and said to his disciples, how difficult will it be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God? If they are rich, how are they going to enter the kingdom of God? Definitely Warren Buffet can't go there. Right? That's why maybe out of that fear he gave everything to charity. Now he realizes that the time has come. Better to give it away to charity. If I don't go to heaven, what will happen? And the disciples were amazed at his words. But Jesus said to them again, children, how difficult it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. A camel can go through the eye of a soina kana mathi won't jai sakse. But a rich person cannot go into my kingdom of God. He's talking of something different. This picture we have made of that person who's so full, rich with vanity. So rich with vanity. He cannot enter into that kingdom of God. Of course, they understand it, give away everything. Just see that when we are depressed, when we are feeling, you know, down inside, when we are not in a proper mood, we are feeling a little less energy, is it because somebody is not feeding our vanity? And most of the time we will see that it is, that is the answer. That we are not getting the attention we want. Nobody has phoned us for 1 hour. As long as our vanity is pampered, gratified, we look very kindly at people. We are very good people. We'll help the poor, we'll give money. But if they don't thank us, if they don't appreciate it, if they are not, they don't have a feeling of gratitude, then we are going to get angry. Now try to see within ourselves, about ourselves, what qualities of our own self do we admire the most? What qualities of ourself? Right? Do we feel that the quality of generosity we admire the most? Or do we feel that the quality of we are loving to most people we admire the most? What do we admire the most? Because our vanity is going to lie over there. So in ourselves, what do we admire the most? What am I most conceited about? Where in myself do I feel that I am better than other people? Where do I compare myself with other people? We can also observe when we meet other people, what do we talk about and what do we hide in ourselves and not talk about? And we will see that every time we are in a party or in a gathering and we meet people, there are only these subjects which we talk about. And so much else we don't want to talk about. And we'll see our vanity is there in which we talk about. Because vanity is talkative and pride is silent. Right? So these are different ways to observe vanity. What is it in me that I cannot forgive? What can I not forgive? Has somebody cheated me 10 years ago and I cannot forgive it? Has somebody insulted me 20 years ago and I still cannot forget it? Has somebody physically slapped me and I cannot forget it? What can I not forget? What am I holding on to? And we'll see our vanity is very close over there. Just a few lines on self-justification. Because it always goes with vanity. Apni jaat ne saachu theraav. It always goes with vanity. Putting ourselves right. Try to make a decision in life that I am not going to defend myself. There is nothing to defend. If it is making a difference in your profession, in the profit, then just observe it and do it in as minimal words as is necessary. But as far as our inner journey is concerned, as far as self-observation is concerned, we don't have to defend anything. Let it bring on other people's harsh words. Let it bring on other people's criticism. The more it comes, the more enduring we become, the more higher we rise. To vindicate oneself, to say that what I did was reasonable, what I did was right, what I did was proper, what I did was just. It happens all the time. The father hits the child, the next day he says, I did it for his good. It happens all the time. Of course, in the old days, they had a saying, spare the rod and spoil the child. Spare the rod and spoil the child. And they don't understand that every time there is some, fight or something in the relationship, they may not become physically violent, but they become aggressive. And aggression is a form of violence. And then they justify. Again, do it. Again, justify. And the pendulum keeps on swinging. When we justify, we are again gaining energy to swing to the other direction. Then we go and throw out all that energy. Again, we come and justify. Again, gain energy to go to the other direction. And this keeps on happening in life. I did not do it on purpose. I am not usually like that. But always defending ourselves. Whenever we defend ourselves, always look inside. This feeling, it always comes from the picture, I am right. I am right. That I can do only good. And we always explain to others that we did no wrong. We were always right. We acted in the general good of everybody. You may feel I am wrong, but my motives behind doing all that were better, good motives. All sorts of things. And everybody else, of course, they misunderstand me. And when we feel we are right, we are so obstinate in life that life cannot penetrate into us. The higher influences of life cannot penetrate. Because obstinacy does not allow the higher influences. It doesn't give us the receptivity, the vulnerability for grace to come in. We are so obstinate. I am right. And this we can only realize through self-observation. And it keeps on happening. People I ask, are you observing yourself? And you say, no, I don't have the time to observe myself. You see? The excuse. And it's not a question of taking out time. You don't have to take out any time. You are just doing the same things in life. If the observation, the light of observation brings about a change, that is different. Where do you have to find the time? You ask a person, why are you so angry and why are you so negative? And again, they will resent it even more. They will become more angry. Who are you to tell me this? And he will never accept that he was wrong, that he was angry and he is wrong. He'll never accept that he's negative. Just don't accept it. And it happens all the time. Happens all the time. Parents have mistreated children. You ask them, they say, we have done everything for their good only. And supposing he even accepts that he is negative, he'll say how good a reason he has to be negative. this is all self-justification. We justify ourselves by denial, that is, I did it, but it was not my fault, or, you know, I did it for the common good, this is justification by denial. Or we may justify ourselves by putting the blame on someone else. I didn't want to get angry, but he made me angry. If he parked his car in the driveway, what can I do? It's always somebody else's fault. And all this comes from this inner picture, I am right. But if we just are little vulnerable, little, we move inside, and whenever we are justifying ourselves, just try to observe, we will see that behind that picture, I am right, there is something else which knows we are wrong. Unless we are very obstinate people, it knows. It comes for a little time, there is a sensitivity, and then we push it down, we suppress it, we repair. We don't want that part to open. We don't want that part to open. We become obstinate. But it knows. And that is the most beautiful part of us. That is conscience. The hidden conscience in us. If that can flower, if that can blossom, the world will be such a beautiful place to live in. Just if that can flower. And it's in everyone. People feel that the more they increase their self-merit, that is, more famous they become, the more people recognize them, the more people appreciate their goodness, their abilities, their intelligence, the more they can collect more and more virtuous deeds by helping somebody here, one more rupee in the bag, giving something to the beggar, one more rupee in the bag, a collection of virtuousness. They feel they rise in life, and they don't realize that they are falling in life. So we just finish by a small slok from the Gita, chapter 16, slok 4. And here Krishna is talking about Asuri Shaktis. Asuri means demonical. But quite deep, Dev, Dano, Asuri Shakti, Devi Shakti, Devi Shakti. Devi is conscious. So I'm not talking about the Devi Shakti, but he's talking here about the Asuri Shakti, the female demons, the female demons, Asuri Shakti. He says, Dambha, Darpa, Abhimana, Chakrodha, Parushyam evacha agnanam abhijatasya partha sampadam asurim. He partha, dambha, garb ane abhiman, tatha krodh ane vani ni kathorta, ane agyan pan asuri sampati ne prapt kareli janmelana lakshano che. Right? Pride, arrogance, conceit, anger, cruelty and ignorance, these are the qualities of one born of impious nature. First he says dumb. Dumb means to show what we are not. Now please understand that for our profession we may have to show something. May have to show something. I remember one forest officer came to me and he said somebody is poaching on wood in the forest. I have to get angry on him. And you're saying this. I'm saying I'm not saying that. I'm saying first observe the self. First observe the self. See that the anger. Be free of the anger. Then so you don't have to immediately react and get angry on him. Wait for some time. Then go and use that anger in whichever way you want to use it for your profession. But before that, pause. Don't become a victim of that anger. Don't become a slave. But as far as our inner observation is concerned, it has no place at all. So, let's see. Because I have umpteen instances of people coming and say, and I know so many gurus in India who get angry every day. Every day they get angry. And then they justify, I do it for the disciples. I'm not doing it for myself. It justifies. Right? And they don't realize that the whole thing is so open, it's just self-love and nothing else. When you look at their looks, they're haughty looks. And they're wearing these orange clothes and lecturing to people. It's very ugly, very, very ugly. So,
Rajen, people like that, how do they live with themselves?
They're dead inside. They don't have to live with anyone.
Because you see it, you see it, I mean, you watch TV and you listen to them and you can make out that it's either propaganda or it's, you know, just getting the attention of people, but you can see there's so much of falseness in it. And you wonder how can they live with it. I mean, they and so thousands of people come and listen to them.
What about Parashuram, the great sage? He used to get angry and he used to be very, you know, that used to say, speak his mind all the truth. From what I know is that he does the least his opinions and his anger on the enemies. So what do you mean?
Try to see it on a more existential scale. That the Kshatriyas had become so overcome with intoxication, power and lust. Now Kshatriya means the emotional center. Kshatriya means the emotional center. It had stooped to the lowest level. Right? And so an existential force had to come which would balance it. And that existential force was Parshuram. So now try to see, his father's name was Jamat Agni. The Agni which has been consciously lit. And out of this, Ram of the axe was born. Parsha means the axe. Ram of the axe was born. And he had a specific role to play. To cut off the negativity of the emotional center. And this negativity of the emotional center was represented by a great king. His name was Kartavirya Arjun. Kartavirya Arjun. And they have this tremendous battle. So it's all very symbolic when you're looking at it. Very symbolic. And what I'll do is, I've written a whole article on Parashuram. So I'll bring that. Right? So we'll take that on the last day. We'll take this also and we'll take that also. I'll just take the story of Parashuram. Okay. Two things we've got. I'll just go through this slok. Right? Time is up. Dambha, huh? To show what we are not. Right? It could be showing in money, it could be showing in ability, it could be showing in knowledge. But what is the greatest dambha in life? That when we use the word I, we don't know who is I. We don't know what is the I. Okay. Darpa. Darpa, right? is an attitude of arrogance, superiority. Right? Then he says, pride, garb, ane abhiman, pride and vanity, he says. Right? So we talked about pride and vanity. Then he talks about krodh. Now, three things are necessary for anger. One, there has to be a desire in the mind. The inner intelligence must be blind, right? And the I must be in a state of unconsciousness, sleep. If these three things come together, only then can we get anger, growth. If there's even a little light in inner intelligence, we know that we cannot get angry. If we have even a feeling that, so what if the desire is not fulfilled, we will not get angry. And if there's a little bit of consciousness, we see that only the ego can get angry, the real I cannot get angry, we will not get angry. But these three conditions have to be fulfilled when we get angry. That is, there must be a desire, there must be blindness in intelligence, that is, no discrimination between right and wrong, and we must be in a state of identification, that is, the ego is completely powerful. Parushyam kathortha, that is, we speak very harsh words. And we don't realize it. So many times we imagine that we have done good for somebody else, but we speak very, very bad language. There's no softness. No softness in our actions, no softness in our talking. And consciousness always brings softness. If it brings obstinacy, if it brings what we call kathortha, hardness, then it is not consciousness. It's not possible. Both of them cannot go together. Agna. There are two types of knowledge. Knowledge of self and knowledge of the ego. It is in our hands to choose whichever one we want to choose. So he's saying agna, knowledge of the ego. All knowledge which the ego gains is nothing but agna. The knowledge of self is real knowledge. Right? So in this small slope, because it was connected with pride and vanity, I said, we'll just have a look at it. Krishna is talking about these things. Make an effort to observe both of them. Transform pride, kill vanity. Keep on transforming pride, make use of pride. Right? Use pride for your inner journey. Pride can overcome laziness, right? And one day pride will turn into real will. That anger comes and we can will it away. Negativity comes and we can will it away. Right? And then we'll be a different human being altogether. Right? So I'll stop over here. So what I'll do is on Wednesday, we'll take this universal mind and subject. Then I'll see if we can have a little time, then we'll take the story of Parshuram also. These are my guru's notes, they're not my notes. Sir. So I'll read from his notes. I thought I'd taken them over here. They're beautiful notes, very beautiful notes.
I think I just dropped the copy. Apparently in India, the police have raided the temples. I think the Indians heard about.
In India?
And they found crores of rupees and kilos of gold stashed away. Either stashed away or money in the bank in fixed deposits. Well, a very famous temple, and one of them is the Tirupati in the south. And it's actually very frightening, but also you wonder what is the sense or the logic behind all this money being stashed.
once I was with Ramdulare Babu, and he was telling me, and we went to meet one guru, his name was Lakshman Chaitanya. And Lakshman Chaitanya had done a yagna, Lakshachandi yagna. Lakshachandi means 1,100,000 fires. In the Kumbh Mela he had done that yagna. I don't know if he's still living or not. And Bapu said that once I had a very big diamond. So I showed it to him, and in front of him I said, Ganga Mata Ki Jai, and I threw it in the Ganga. And he, for a number of days, he hired divers to look for that. It's two ways of taking it. Two ways of taking it. One is that the people who are controlling the temples, they have no sense of discrimination. So they're just accumulating wealth. And the other way is to take it the real Indian way. Okay? Wealth has its uses, and otherwise it doesn't matter what happens to it. Right? So it is whichever way you take it. So he was telling me this story, and he says that, do you know these sadhus? Some of them have more wealth than our whole government put together. And he used to tell me different stories. He said he had a small place in Badrinath. So he said that one day I went to the idol at Badrinath and I put a, what do you call, necklace of diamonds around it. So then after 6 months I came back to Badrinath and I saw that somebody else had put a better necklace than mine. So then I got another necklace and I put a better necklace than that. So this is how we used to talk about all these things. And people had looked for wealth and he just knew where to find wealth. You see? And once the whole Sadhu Samaj in Vrindavan, they were having a discussion on whether Krishna had a real golden Dwarka or it's all symbolic. So then the Sadhu Samaj came to this thing that, no, it is all symbolic, it cannot be real. So he said, wait a minute. And he came back and he said, go take this sand, go to the jeweler and ask whether this sand is sand or is it gold. So they went to the jeweler said it's 50% gold. After that everybody was behind him, where did you get this sand? Because he used to live in Dwarka a lot, a couple of months of the year. And the person whom he used to live with, one day saw that he had come with all kinds of different stones and all that, and he saw him putting it in his, he had a big, you know, what we used to, not a rucksack, but we used to call it a bagal thela, huge, and he put everything in there. And there were so many gold pieces and all that. And he said in the morning when he went, he didn't have this. So he said, tomorrow I'm going to follow him. So next day he followed him, you know, and he went to all kinds of places and he saw a river where he could literally see a small stream going where there was gold shining under it, you know. So he said, now I'll come back to this place. So after Bapu left his home, went somewhere else, he went looking for that place, he never found it. So there are mysteries in life, how these temples got all of this, but I don't think it's a big deal. It's really not a big deal. So what if they have it, and if they don't have it, so what?
They can feed and build so many houses that people
are... It doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. It's just our pendulum moving from one direction to the other. But it could be just a gross accumulation of wealth. But why should we go into it? It has no meaning at all. But the temples in India have a lot of wealth. You know, at someone's house, he took me for darshan. and there were 12 Jyotirlings. Now, those Jyotirlings, they were made of a blackish yellow stone, and they were all arranged there. Such beautiful stone, the very feeling of the stone was so beautiful, just looking at it, and it must have been priceless. I mean, there's no... So I'm asking him that, where did this come from? He says, oh, I was having a dip in the Narmada one day, one came out, then I went again, another came out, and now, you know, I have this small ashram on the Narmada, so we go to have a dip in the Narmada, and every time I remember, one came out, another came out. This is it. But you miss something very important if you think like that. But any other kind tame tatvik vastu bhuli jao cho chhodi diyo. This is written for those willing to consider the possibility that something other than just luck or heredity bestows happiness on one and failure on another. એટલે આ એની માટે લખાયેલું છે જે લોકો વિચારવા માટે તૈયાર છે કે ખાલી લક ખાલી વારસો થી ખુશી નથી આવતી કે કોઈને શું કહેવાય ફેલિયર નથી આવતું કંઈક બીજું છે ઇફ યુ સીક હેલ્પ એન્ડ આર નોટ એફ્લિક્ટેડ બાય અ ક્લોઝ્ડ માઇન્ડ વી શેલ સ્ટાર્ટ વિથ અ ફ્યુ આઈડિયાઝ ફોર Nothing that is law is not reason. થોડેક આઈડિયાઝ તમને આપશે અહીંયા અને બધું જે બને છે ઇટ ઇઝ અકોર્ડિંગ ટુ લો એવરીથિંગ હેપન્સ અકોર્ડિંગ ટુ લો સો ઇઝ જસ્ટ ઓપનિંગ આર માઇન્ડ દેટ દેર ઇઝ સમથિંગ ધ કોઝિસ ઓફ ઇવેન્ટ્સ લાય સમવેર ડીપર એન્ડ મે બી વી કુડ ટચ ધોઝ કોઝિસ Color, weight, density, firmness are all properties of objects. એવું આપણે રાખીએ કે જ્યાં ન સમજાય તો હું એ વાક્યને ગુજરાતી કરો કે બધાય કરો, એ કોઈ કર્યું? હા, બધાય કરો. કલર એટલે રંગ, વજન, કોસ્તા ડેન્સિટી, ફર્મનેસ એટલે શું કે શું એને જોર, હા, આ બધાય વસ્તુઓની પ્રોપર્ટીઓ છે. And we find that these objects are made of the same substances in varying physical and chemical combinations. અને બધી જે વસ્તુઓ એ કેમિકલ સબસ્ટન્સથી બને છે એનું કોમ્બિનેશન અલગ અલગ છે. So we say that objects composing our environment are made of matter, and the state in which matter usually appears is visible. એટલે જે વસ્તુ આપણે આજુબાજુ છે એ બધા મેટરથી બનેલા છે, અને જે સ્થિતિમાં છે આપણને પાંચ ઇન્દ્રિયોથી દેખાય છે. વી કેન સી ધેમ વિથ ધ ફાઇવ સેન્સીસ. નાઉ એઝ વી લુક મોર ઇન્ટેન્ટલી વી ઓબ્ઝર્વ ધેટ ધેર આર અધર કન્ડિશન્સ ઇન આર વર્લ્ડ ધેટ આર ઇનવિઝિબલ. Now he's saying that there are causes behind what is apparent. So what we see is color, this, that and everything. But behind that there are causes which are invisible. એટલે જે દેખાય છે એ દુનિયા પાછળ અદ્રશ્ય કારણો છે. We think, but we do not see our thoughts. વિચાર દેખાતા નથી. Right? એટલે supposing I perform any action. Before the action is the thought. The thought is unseen, but the thought is the cause of the action. Right? So this is simple. Ki vichar dekhata nahi, but apne je kai kariye che ni pachad vichar che. A great drama of forces constantly unfolds before us. Apne dekhatu nahi, we cannot see with our eyes. But behind every unseen object, behind everything, every seen object, everything that we can see with our five senses, there is a whole play, a whole drama of unseen forces. એટલે હરેક સ્થૂલ વસ્તુની પાછળ સૂક્ષ્મતામાં ઘણા બધા શક્તિઓની રમત ચાલે છે. So we say that the objects composing our environment, we do not see the forces or energies themselves, but they are the cause of all that we do and see. So આ શક્તિઓ આપણને દેખાતા નથી, પણ છતાંય એ બધી વસ્તુ જે આપણે કરીએ છીએ અને જે દેખાય છે એની પાછળ આ શક્તિઓ છે. What we see are the results called phenomena or actions and states of being. Je aapne dekhai che e phenomena che je vastu banyo. Actions and states of being. Now this is very important. Everybody has a level of being. And that level of being has a spectrum. Everybody's level of being has a spectrum. That spectrum can only do so much in life. If we want something which is not in our spectrum, then we have to change the spectrum. Now, if I want something in my life which is not in the range of my spectrum, then I am always going to encounter failure in life. The level of being, એટલે આપણું હોવાપણ, આપણું હોવાપણનું પોતાનું એક ક્ષમતા છે, એક સ્પેક્ટ્રમ છે. એ સ્પેક્ટ્રમની બહાર જો આપણે કંઈ પણ મેળવવા જશું તો આપણને જીવનમાં અસફળતા જ મળશે. એટલે આપણા નસીબમાં જે છે એ જ આપણને મળી શકે. સ્પેક્ટ્રમ એટલે એની ક્ષમતા. So we live not only in a visible world of matter, but also in the invisible world of forces and energies that produce the visible things in our environment. એટલે આપણે બે દુનિયામાં સાથે જીવીએ છીએ. એક જે પાંચ ઇન્દ્રિયોની દુનિયા, એક અદ્રશ્ય શક્તિઓની દુનિયા. હકીકતે ઇન્દ્રિયોની દુનિયામાં જે કંઈ આપણે અનુભવીએ છીએ એ શક્તિઓની દુનિયામાંથી ઉત્પન્ન થાય છે. So whatever we see with our five senses is because of forces on a different scale, invisible forces. We live, no human being has ever seen a mind. Koi par manushya man nahi jodu. Everything we do, individually or collectively, begins first in the thought of the thing. કંઈ પણ આપણે કરીએ છીએ કોઈ વસ્તુ મેળવવા માટે તો પહેલા વિચારથી ચાલુ કરીએ છીએ. નો મેટર હાઉ સડનલી વી ડુ અ થિંગ એટ ટાઈમ્સ વી થિંક ઓફ ઇટ ફર્સ્ટ. ઇવન વેન વી ડુ સમથિંગ વેરી ફાસ્ટ સડનલી દેર ઇઝ ઓલવેઝ ધ થોટ બિહાઇન્ડ ઇટ. એટલે વિચાર પાછળ છે. અ બ્રિજ ઓર અ રેલ રોડ કેન બી ક્રિએટેડ બાય ધ માઇન્ડ ઓફ મેન. But man cannot create a tree or an ocean or a river. એટલે બ્રિજ અને રેલવે પાટા એ મનુષ્યનું મન બનાવી શકે, પણ મનુષ્ય ઝાડ કે સમુદ્ર કે નદી બનાવી શકતો નથી. Yet they too must have begun in a mind. But that those rivers and oceans which we see, before they became physically visible, they must have been in some mind. એ જે આપણને દરિયો દેખાય છે, એ નદી દેખાય છે, એ વ્યક્ત થયું, પાંચ ઇન્દ્રિયોને ક્ષમતામાં આવી ગયું, પાંચ ઇન્દ્રિયોની અનુભૂતિમાં આવી ગયું, એની પહેલા કોઈકના મનમાં હતો, કોઈ મનમાં હતો. In what mind and with what thought did they begin? E kaya man ni andar, in what mind and with what thought? E man ma vichar kai jato vichar hatu ke aa vastu bani saki. So we have before us two different pictures. One springs from the efforts of man on the visible plane. The other is directed from some invisible plane and is not due to man's. એટલે આપણી પાસે બે ચિત્ર છે. એક જે મનુષ્યની પ્રયત્નમાંથી બનતી વસ્તુઓ જે આપણને દેખાય છે, અને બીજું જે મનુષ્યએ પ્રયત્ન નથી કર્યું પણ છતાંય કોઈક અદ્રશ્ય આયામમાંથી બનેલું છે. નો સેન્સિબલ મેન બિલીવ્સ ધેટ મેન જસ્ટ હેપન્ડ. He too is a phenomenon, a fact with an invisible cause. કોઈ પણ શું કહેવાય વિચાર કરતો માણસ એને એમ નહીં લાગે કે મનુષ્ય એમને આવી ગયો. મનુષ્ય એક ઘટના છે જેનું કારણ ક્યાંક અદ્રશ્યમાં પડેલું છે. But man did not cause himself, something else brought him into being. Manushya potani jatne potane banayo nathi, kai biju ene vyakt karelu chhe. Therefore this something else causes not only mountains and oceans which are beyond man's control, but also causes everything that man appears to cause. So man feels that he builds railroads, he builds bridges, but what he is saying now that this invisible cause which makes the mountains and which makes the river is also the cause of man, is also, and that is why all man's efforts of whether he has built railroads or bridges is because of that cause. એટલે એ કહે છે કે એ જે ઇન્ટેલિજન્સ હતું જેને દરિયો બનાવ્યો, નદીઓ બનાવ્યો, એને મનુષ્યને બનાવ્યો. મનુષ્યને એમ છે કે એને બ્રિજ અને રેલ રોડ બનાવ્યા, પણ એ જે કોઝ હતું મનુષ્યને પણ એ જ કોઝે બનાવેલું. એટલે મનુષ્યની બધી વસ્તુઓ જે બનાવેલી છે એની પાછળ એ સત્તા છે. Thus we see that there is but one basic cause of all things. One basic, ek cause che, ek satta che, che mati badu utpan thi. Whether therefore, we therefore call it the first cause. The basic cause, we call it the first cause. Some call it God. Some call it God. Whatever term we use, it or that operates through mind. એટલે એ કહે છે કે બધી વસ્તુઓની પાછળ એક મૂળભૂત કારણ છે. ઘણા લોકો એ મૂળભૂત કારણને ભગવાન કહે છે. આપણે એને ફર્સ્ટ કોઝ કહીશું, પહેલું કારણ. પણ જે કંઈ હશે એને વ્યર્થ, એને પણ કામ કરવું હોય તો એને મનમાંથી જ કામ કરવું પડે, મનનો ઉપયોગ કરીને જ કામ કરવું પડે છે. ઇટ કોઝિસ all things that we call it or that. એટલે જ્યાં જ્યાં આપણે શબ્દ વાપરીએ, wherever we use the words it or that or whatever, has all been caused by that one cause. And that cause is the universal mind, the mind of God. All power comes from one source. બધી શક્તિનો મૂળભૂત કારણ એક જ છે. Just as it did before the beginning of things. Kai pan hatu nahi tyare pan e shakti to tyan j padeli hati. This great invisible cause works through the universal mind. If we should find that each of us can use that fact or force consciously to our own advantage, would not that be a great discovery? E je mulbhut karan, that first cause. If we should find, each of us can use that, apne jo e upyog kar sakiye, consciously, to our own advantage, apno bhala mate, would that not be a great discovery? Individually, we are tied to that one infinite source, and we individually vary a lot in the amount of power we develop from the same voltage. Harek vyakti, every man, is connected to that source. It all comes from one voltage. How much power we are able to draw from it depends on our level of being. હરેક વ્યક્તિ એની સાથે જ કનેક્ટેડ છે, પણ એમાંથી કેટલું શક્તિ એ ઉત્પન્ન કરી શકે છે એ પોતાના લેવલ ઓફ બીંગ ઉપર આધારિત છે. ધ ડિવેલપમેન્ટ એન્ડ બેટરિંગ ઓફ યોર ઓન લાઈફ ડિપેન્ડ્સ ઓન યોર લર્નિંગ હાઉ ટુ ડ્રો મોર પાવર ફ્રોમ ધેટ ગ્રેટ સોર્સ. તમારે જો તમારા જીવનમાં કંઈક સારું કરવું હોય તો એ જે મૂળભૂત કારણ છે એમાંથી વધારે ને વધારે શક્તિ કેમ તમે ખેંચી શકો એની ઉપર આધારિત છે. હાઉ ટુ ડ્રો મોર પાવર ફ્રોમ ધેટ સોર્સ. હ્યુમન મશીન્સ કેન ડ્રો મોર પાવર, મિકેનિકલ મશીન્સ કેન નોટ ડ્રો મોર પાવર. દે કેન ઓન્લી ડૂ વોટ ઇઝ પ્રોગ્રામ્ડ, વોટ ધે આર મેન્ટ ટુ ડુ. So now he is talking about the universal mind. Please understand, when we are talking about impression food, it is that universal mind coming into us as an impression every moment. Whether we can digest that impression depends on our level of consciousness. The universal mind takes on two different aspects. Ena be ayam che universal mind. One aspect includes the direction of the activities pertaining to man's normal material environment exterior to him. Whatever is happening in the range of the five senses, that is one aspect of the universal mind. જે જે વસ્તુઓ આપણા પાંચ ઇન્દ્રિયોને આગળ છે, પાંચ ઇન્દ્રિયોને ક્ષમતામાં છે, એનો એક આયામ છે. The other portion of the universal mind within each of us takes charge of the direction and utilization of forces that operate independently of our conscious or objective phase of mind. અને એ યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડનો બીજો આયામ છે જે જેના પ્રત્યે આપણે કોન્શિયસ જ નથી અને છતાંય એ કામ કરે છે. ઇટ ઓપરેટ્સ ઇન્ડિપેન્ડન્ટ ઓફ આર કોન્શિયસનેસ. ઇટ ડાયરેક્ટ્સ ધ ફંક્શન્સ ઓફ રેસ્પિરેશન, ડાયજેશન એન્ડ ઓલ ધ ઓટોમેટિક ફંક્શન્સ ઓફ ધ બોડી દેટ સસ્ટેન લાઈફ દેટ ગો વિધાઉટ આર કોગ્નિશન. This phase of the universal mind within us we term subjective. હા, એટલે આપણી અંદર જે ડાયજેશન અને બધી શરીરની ક્રિયા કરે છે એ યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડનો બીજો આયામ છે. એટલે એને બે આયામ કીધા, ઓબ્જેક્ટિવ આયામ જે આપણને દેખાય છે અને સબ્જેક્ટિવ આયામ જે આપણને દેખાતું નથી. Two parts, two aspects he made of the universal mind. The aspect which we can see with our consciousness, that he calls the objective aspect, and the one which we cannot see is the subjective aspect. Right? Now, what the objective controls and what the subjective controls? In the human body, the objective mind controls the cerebrospinal system, the conscious nervous system. Right? The subjective mind works through the sympathetic nervous system. These two systems are almost entirely separate, except that the vagus nerve ties them together in one place. Right? એટલે આપણી અંદર કોન્શિયસ નર્વસ સિસ્ટમ અને સિમ્પથેટિક નર્વસ સિસ્ટમ. સિમ્પથેટિક નો બીજો ભાગ કરીએ તો પેરાસિમ્પથેટિક, એટલે એને બે ભાગ કહેવાય, કોન્શિયસ અને sympathetic. Conscious is controlled by the objective mind, je indriya gamya chhe, but je sympathetic nervous system and the parasympathetic nervous system is controlled by the subjective mind, je indriya gamya nahi, which the senses cannot see. The fibers of one system actually join and fuse into the fibers of the other system in the vagus nerves. Thus the two, subjective and objective, are physically one. So subjective mind che, objective mind che, e kaam ma juda che, par sharir ni andar beu jodayela che. Etle sharir ni andar to ek j physical organ che. The junction in the vagus nerve of the two systems is two-way. The stream of force can go either way or even both ways at the same time. This distinction between objective and subjective mind is extremely important. હવે બેઉ જે જગ્યાએ મળે છે શરીરની અંદર, where the two minds meet in the body, the vagus nerve, there is a two-way valve. There is a two-way valve. So if man learns, he can use the subjective mind consciously. He knows how to operate. એટલે મનુષ્ય જો ધારી શકે તો એ સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ જે એના કોન્શિયસનેસની બહાર છે એનો એ ઉપયોગ કરી શકે છે. Ordinarily, these two phases of mind operate independently. Normally એ બે જગ્યાએ ઓપરેટ નથી કરતા, બે અલગ અલગ ઓપરેટ કરે છે. The objective mind under certain circumstances can and does control the subjective, which we see in breathing. Right? In breathing is a function of the subjective mind, but if I consciously I can control my breathing. So then it becomes a function of the objective mind. Right? એટલે બંને અલગ કામ કરે છે પણ અમુક શું કહેવાય સર્કમસ્ટન્સીસમાં એ બંને હા એકબીજાનું કામ કરી શકે. The subjective mind cannot stop its work as long as there is life in the organism. જ્યાં સુધી જીવન છે ત્યાં સુધી subjective mind keeps on working as long as there is life. It has few orders to carry out except those which it received at birth. It has been programmed as birth. And in birth. This is the jack of clubs. Now he's talking of how to activate the king of clubs, which has unlimited powers. Right? We saw that when we did the cards. So he's just now, all the automatic functions which are programmed at birth is the jack of clubs. Right? એટલે જીવનમાં એ જે અત્યારે સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ જે કામ કરેલું છે એ બધું પહેલેથી પ્રોગ્રામ કરીને રહ્યું છે. આપણે જો ઉપયોગ કરી શકીએ તો એમાંથી ખૂબ શક્તિ મેળવી શકીએ. There are two other kinds of orders which you can give to the subjective mind and which it can and will carry out automatically exactly as ordered or told. Saying that this mind is programmed, but you can order it to carry out something and it will automatically, as it carries out all the programs, it will automatically also carry out your order. એટલે એ કહે છે કે આ જે સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ છે એ શરીરની બધી ક્રિયાઓ સંભાળે છે પણ તમે એને ઓર્ડર કરી શકો છો તે કરવા માટે. અને જેમ ઓટોમેટિકલી શરીરની ક્રિયાઓ ચલાવે છે એમ એ જ વસ્તુ ઓટોમેટિકલી કરશે. There is no such thing as luck. Everything is a result of some cause. You get pleasant or unpleasant results from your actions depending very largely on how fully you realize and act with the infinite power of the universal mind. એટલે લક જેવું કઈ નથી. હરેક જે વસ્તુ બને છે એની પાછળ કારણ છે. તમને સફળતા કે અસફળતા મળે છે એ ડાયરેક્ટલી તમે યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડનો કઈ રીતે ઉપયોગ કરો છો. યુ આર વેહિકલ ઓફ એક્સપ્રેશન ઓફ ધેટ યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડ. નાઉ વી બિગિન ટુ કેચ અ ગ્લિમર ઓફ ઇનવિઝિબલ કોઝિસ ઓફ વિઝિબલ ઇફેક્ટ્સ. Nature does not develop faculties uselessly. એટલે એ જે અદ્રશ્ય મન છે યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડ છે એનું આપણે એમાંથી આપણે બનેલા છે આપણે એનો ઉપયોગ કરી શકીએ છીએ. There is absolute unity in all things in the universal mind, regardless of their apparent physical separateness. Everything looks separate, but in the universal mind, it is all joined together. Like you have one wheel, the universal mind is the hub of the wheel. Everything which we see separate in life is just spokes coming out of the hub of the wheel. But at the hub, the universal mind, all life is joined together. All the spokes have their common origin in the hub. એટલે આરાઓ બધાય હબ ને મળે છે. આરાઓ અલગ અલગ છે પણ અંદર યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડ માંથી જ આ બધાય આરાઓ નીકળે છે. As each spoke goes towards the rim, it becomes seemingly separate. Human spokes in the wheel of life too often entertain this false idea that they are separate. એટલે હરેક મનુષ્ય every man is just a spoke in the wheel of life and at the hub where universal mind is everybody is joined to that hub. That universal mind is common in all of us. Everyone is made of one hidden stuff. So the very first task in remodeling the things in our life that do not suit us is to get fixed in our memories this fact of our unity with all things in the universal mind. Right? And we like some things in life, we don't like some things in life, we want to change anything in our life. So we must understand that all of us are joined to that hub. And what we want to change is also joined to that hub. Everything comes from that one source. Badhu ekat source mathi aave chhe. એટલે જે વસ્તુ આપણને જીવનમાં બદલાવવું છે એ પણ એ જ અંદરના હબની સાથે જોડાયેલું છે. That we cannot be alone, that we have all the creative and sustaining power in heaven and earth within us, waiting to be used. When we know how to, there is a specific way in which we can make that demand to the greatest power in the universe. આપણે એકલા નથી. સ્વર્ગની અંદર જેટલી પણ શક્તિ અને જેટલી પણ ક્રિએટિવ પાવર એ બધું આપણી અંદર છે. વી હેવ ઓલ ધ ક્રિએટિવ પાવર વેઇટિંગ ટુ બી યુઝડ. ઇટ કેન બી યુઝડ બટ ઓનલી વી મસ્ટ નો હાઉ ટુ. ધેર ઇઝ અ સ્પેસિફિક વે, એક સ્પેસિફિક ટેકનિક છે, એક સ્પેસિફિક વે. We can make that demand, to demand anything we want to the greatest power in the universe. Now he is going to explain how it is done. Our individual subjective mind is the immediate personal link with the universal mind. Our breath comes in, we call it my breath. Impressions come in, we say my mind. This is our individual mind. This individual mind is nothing like but a part of the universal mind. Just now, because we have separated from the universal mind, right? But actually it is like a bucket of water in the Ganga, right? But the bucket now thinks it is separate from the Ganga. It has forgotten that it is lying in the Ganga River, Ganges River. So the individual mind is nothing but a part of the universal mind. એ જે વૈશ્વિક મન છે અને આપણું જે નાનું વ્યક્તિગત મન છે એ વ્યક્તિગત મન વૈશ્વિક મનનો જ ભાગ છે. And since all things are possible to the universal mind, એ યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડ માં બધું શક્ય છે. The power of an individual expression of that universal mind, such as your subjective mind, is limited only by the arbitrary conditions of time, space, force and other natural laws under which you as a human being are limited. એ જે વૈશ્વિક મન છે એની અંદર બધી શક્તિ છે અને આપણું જે વ્યક્તિગત મન છે એમાં ખાલી આપણે શરીરમાં છે એટલે કોઈ જગ્યાએ આપણે જીવીએ છીએ, એનું અમુક બધા કન્ડિશન્સ છે, તો એનાથી આપણે બંધાયેલા છે. પણ બાકી આપણી અંદર એ જ શક્તિ છે જે યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડમાં છે. સો વી આર લિમિટેડ બીકોઝ વી આર ઇન અ બોડી. We are limited by certain things of the body. So we are born at a certain space, we are limited by that space. We are born at a certain time in history, we are limited by time. And it has no further limitations. He is saying now this individual mind, aaje vyaktigat man che, it has no further limitations. E badhu kari sake che. But your subjective mind, directed inwardly to all the worlds or inner planes, having access to that vast power of the universal mind, drawing life from the very source of everything, that is, can accomplish anything which is not prohibited by the laws of time and space. એટલે આપણું વ્યક્તિગત મન જો અંદર જાય અને અંદર સ્થૂલથી સૂક્ષ્મ બધી દુનિયાઓ છે અને એ એક એક દુનિયાની બધી શક્તિ જો એ મેળવી શકે તો એક ગમે તે કરી શકે આપણું વ્યક્તિગત મન. ખાલી આપણે જે સમયમાં જન્મેલા છે, જે સ્પેસ છે, એના જે લિમિટેશન્સ છે એ આપણને લાગે, બાકી આ વ્યક્તિગત મન આપણું ગમે તે કરી શકે છે. સો વી આર ઓનલી બાઉન્ડ બાય ટાઈમ એન્ડ સ્પેસ, અધરવાઇઝ ધીસ ઇન્ડિવિજ્યુઅલ માઇન્ડ વોઝ ધ સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ કેન ડુ એનીથિંગ. In consciously creating circumstances, we reverse the process of physical sight. Okay, now I see something, an object, and I say I want this object. So I see it and then a thought comes that I want it. Now we are reversing this process. We are first creating the thought and the thought creates the object. Right? એટલે જ્યારે આ વસ્તુને હું જોઉં છું, પહેલા આને જોઉં છું, પછી અંદર વિચાર ઉત્પન્ન થાય છે. હવે આપણે વિચારને ઉત્પન્ન કરશો અને વિચાર આ વસ્તુને હકીકત બનાવશે. When we did mantra yoga, we had talked about something. That everything was created by a mantra. And if we learn that mantra, then the very secret of creation is in our hands, right? Instead of seeing mentally a picture of what we know already exists physically, we use the giant power within us by impressing our individual subjective mind with a picture of what we want to see to come about physically. This is going to be difficult. I'll try to explain this in a different way. Instead of seeing mentally a picture of what we know already exists physically, we use the giant power within us by impressing our individual subjective mind with the picture of what we want to see come about physically. એટલે મને ઘર જોઈએ છે, રાઈટ? તો એ ઘરનું પિક્ચર લઈને હું નહીં ઇન્ડિવિજ્યુઅલ માઇન્ડને ઇમ્પ્રેસ કરું. હા, આપણને જે જોઈએ છે એ ઇન્ડિવિજ્યુઅલ માઇન્ડ, સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ, હા, એની ઉપર ઇમ્પ્રેસ કરશે. Just try to explain this. We have to get into the spirit of the thing. Now, what would be the spirit of a house? What would be the spirit of a house? The house is an externalized object. Now he's saying, don't take a picture of that externalized object and put it on the subjective mind. It's not going to work. Yeah. You have to put something internal. What is this internal? Can you understand what I'm trying to say? What would it be? See, when we think of a house, we forget the primary need of a house. The primary need of a house, which would be shelter, right? Protection from the elements, right? So the primary need of a house is shelter. That is the spirit of the house, right? So he says, when you are impressing upon the subjective mind, don't impress the picture of the house. You impress what you need on the, try to go into the spirit of the thing. So in consciously creating circumstances, right, you've done this. So you are to see a picture of what you want. When you say, I want shelter, I want, how will you picturize that? You cannot picturize it as a house. You have to picturize it as a feeling that I want something to give me shelter. I want something to give me comfort. I want something to give me a homely feeling, right? And you're putting that feeling on the subjective mind. First in your mind and later with your physical eye after it comes into externalization. So, pehla e vastu nu moolbhut karan shu chhe e vicharu ke mare ghar seni mate joye chhe. So, e ghar mane shanti thi reva mate, protection mate, suraksha mate, varsad pade to enathi bachava mate. એ જે વસ્તુ છે એનું પિક્ચર બનાવીને મૂકવાનું છે, ઘરનું પિક્ચર નથી મૂકવાનું. સો યુ ઇમેજિન અ પિક્ચર બાય મીન્સ ઓફ અ ડેફિનેટ ટેકનિક, યુ મેક ઇટ કમ ટ્રુ બિફોર યોર આઈઝ. વેન યુ પુટ ધીસ ઓન ધ સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ, ઇટ ઇમ્પ્રિન્ટ્સ ઇટ ઓન ધ યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડ. સો he saying now, do not accept whatever may come before your eyes. No, you're not getting it. Not getting it. I want a home. Right? So now I'm going into the spirit of a home. But when I ask, I'm picturizing that spirit, but to my external senses, a kind of shape of some home is going to come. He said, don't accept that. Don't accept that. Right? Something is going to be come externally to the senses. Kahi chitra aavse, kahi dekhase. Now, when you see this external picture, determine yourself what shall come before your eyes. You determine what you want. But first, when you ask for the spirit of the thing. Out of the spirit of the thing, there will be some externalization. Man ni andar kai chitra utpan thase. And then you change that picture exactly the way you want it to come. I'll just go into this in a different way, then come back to this. We have done this, that everything we see is caused by something or else it could not exist. Now, try to see the connection between cause and effect. Right? Cause is always at a deeper level than the effect. Right? The cause is in my thoughts. Effect will be in my action. Right? Cause is always higher than effect. Now, the cause of the same thing can vary. Supposing I want a swimming pool in my home. The cause of the same thing can be different. Somebody wants a swimming pool just to show to people. He's not going to use it. Right? So the cause is different. Another person is health conscious, so he wants a swimming pool to swim. So there the cause is different. A third person wants the swimming pool to make his house look more harmonious. Right? So, each one, the effect is the same, but the cause can be different. Right? You see, he's talking about mind over here. Try to understand this because it's very, very important. One effect can have multiple causes. Supposing we are seeing a mystery movie where there is a murder. So the visible effect is the murder of the person. But to go to the cause of the murder, so many things the mind will have to do. Can you see? Now, we are now doing something reverse. The mind is first creating the causes and asking for the actualization of those causes. But behind the cause is the cause of the cause. What can be the cause of the cause? एक आपने मिस्ट्री पिक्चर जोई है तो एक जन मर्डर थे तो पची ये तो घटना देखी थी छे पांच इंद्रियों थी पर मन थी पची आपने के आ मर्डर पाछळ नु कारण शु हतुं ए मन थी आपने शोधीए छे ए मन अदृश्य छे એ ઘણા બધા કારણ શોધશે ઘણી જગ્યાએ તો ફીલ થશે અને ફરીથી કારણ શોધશે. Right. So the same process we are going through over here. We are making use of the mind to make the body, not to go from the body to the cause. From the cause we are coming to the body. આ ઉલટી ગંગા છે, ઉલટી યાત્રા છે. Now just try to understand here a little bit. What is the ends? What is the ends? The ends is the cause of cause. Cause of cause. What could that be? Supposing I say this is a chair. This is a chair. So chair is the effect. Right? Now from the chair you will go to the cause. So you will say carpenter made the chair. The tools are the cause of the chair. The design is the cause of the chair. Right? But what is the cause of the cause? Wood. You say wood is the cause of the cause. But even then, if you go deeper into the cause of the cause, what would be the cause of the cause? There was a desire to sit comfortably. There was a desire to sit comfortably. Right? So you keep on. Now, where will the universal mind come in this? Try to understand. Where will the universal mind? Kya khursi che, to eno karan su che, lakru che, suthar che. આ બધા ઘણા કારણ છે, પણ એ બધા પાછળનું કારણ શું છે કે માણસને સરખીથી બેસવું. હવે અહીંયા યુનિવર્સલ, હવે આ કારણની પાછળ, લેટ્સ પુટ ઇટ અનધર વે, સપોઝિંગ વી સે ધેટ ધ કોઝ ઓફ ધ કોઝ ઇઝ ઓનલી અ પર્ટિક્યુલર કોઝ ઇન ધ જનરલ કોઝ ઓફ ધ યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડ. Try to go in. So I say I have a desire to be comfortable. Now try to go into a general cause of the universal mind. So is the universal mind trying, has only one aim, for man to evolve? To man to evolve. Is my desire for comfort a part of that universal mind's total general desire for evolution? It is a particular cause in that general cause. And that particular cause gives rise to a cause which is wood, etc. That all comes together to make the effect called chair. But that chair is nothing but the universal mind. Now, am I coming across in this? Try to understand. You got it a little? That every cause will have a cause of cause. And that cause will be a particular cause of the general cause of the universe. Because truth is so multidimensional. It will be just a small part of that whole truth. But it will still be a part of that truth. So, in the end, the real cause for everything is the universal mind. It is that a desire of the universal mind that man should evolve, man should go to better and better states, to higher and higher states. That inner desire of the universal mind is the cause of everything. Can you get it? So the cause behind the cause is here. And that is why he's talking about this. I just wanted to put this into his cause, effect, and cause of cause. And the cause of cause is only a small part of one big cause. A small part of one big cause. Aap pakdai baki Gujarati pakdai. Ke aap khursi che e effect che. Eni pachar na karano je che aap le ki duke atla karano che. But eni pachar no karan che ke mare કમ્ફર્ટેબલી બેસવું છે. રાઈટ? તો એ કમ્ફર્ટેબલી બેસવું છે એ કારણની પાછળનું કારણ છે. પણ એ જે કારણની પાછળનું કારણ છે એ વૈશ્વિક મન, જે ભગવાનનું મનનું જે અંદર જે છુપાયેલી જે ઈચ્છા છે એનો ભાગ જ છે. અને ભગવાનના મનની અંદર જે છુપાયેલી ઈચ્છા છે કે મનુષ્ય વધારે ને વધારે કોન્શિયસનેસમાં આગળ જાય, તો એનો એક ભાગ છે કે મારે કમ્ફર્ટેબલી બેસવું છે. હવે પકડાય છે એટલે હરેક જે વસ્તુ આપણને દેખાય છે એની પાછળ કારણ છે. એ કારણો ઘણા બધા છે. એ કારણોની પાછળ કારણનું કારણ છે અને એ કારણનું કારણ જે છે એ ભગવાનના મનનું ભાર છે. હવે પકડાય છે શું કહેવા માંગુ છું. Now we go back to his notes, right? So do not accept what comes before your eyes. Determine for yourself what shall come. એટલે અંદર વિચાર કર્યું કે મારે કમ્ફર્ટેબલી બેસવું છે. આઈ મેડ અ થોટ, આઈ વોન્ટ ટુ સિટ કમ્ફર્ટેબલી. Then a wooden chair came in front of my eyes over here. I say, I don't want the wooden chair, I want one with a little padding over here. Right? So determine what is. Satisfy yourself that your predominating desire is worthy, rational, natural and not being harmful to anyone. Be very sure that what you are asking for, it is worthy. Worthy એટલે you deserve it. You deserve it. તમે એના લાયક છો જે તમે માંગો છો. Rational એટલે હવામાં વસ્તુ નથી. It is rational. Right? Natural. અને કોઈને દુઃખ પહોંચાડવાનું નથી. કોઈને harmful નથી. This you should be sure. Now fix the desire. Now fix the desire. Away fix karo. Not as you hope it may be, but as if it were already a fact. See yourself in the picture, actually occupied in doing exactly what you would do if you were already externalized. એટલે પછી તમારા ડિઝાયરને ફિક્સ કરો એ ખુરશી કે ભાઈ આ જ ખુરશી જોઈએ છે અને એ ખુરશીમાં હું બેઠેલો છું અને એન્જોય. You see yourself in the chair, you're enjoying the chair. Just keep the image in mind, thinking of it objectively as often as your activities permit. Now, we did this with the subjective mind, now we give it to the objective mind. Right? So the subjective mind asked from the universal mind. Now the subjective mind is fixed, okay, this is what I want, and he passes this on to the objective mind, and the objective mind is involved in all our activities in the day. Whenever it remembers the picture which it asked for. It's just a form of remembering, just a form of remembering. Hold this picture, mental picture, as long as you can. એટલે આપણું પેલા એને જે શું છે માઇન્ડના બે ભાગ કર્યા, સબ્જેક્ટિવ અને ઓબ્જેક્ટિવ. ઓબ્જેક્ટિવ એટલે કોન્શિયસ માઇન્ડ. પછી એને કીધું સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડમાંથી કઈ રીતે માંગવાનું, એટલે અંદરનો પહેલા આપણે વિચાર કર્યો, એ વિચારનો વિચાર કર્યો, પછી એમાંથી વસ્તુ ઉપર આવ્યા, એ વસ્તુ ફિક્સ કર્યું કે આ જ જોઈએ છે. હવે સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડનું કામ પૂરું થઈ ગયું, ઓબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ આવી. ઓબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ આખો દિવસ કામકાજમાં છે, પણ જ્યારે જ્યારે એને યાદ આવે ત્યારે એ ચિત્ર એ યાદ કરશે, એટલે ખાલી એને મનમાં પકડી રાખશે, ધારણા કરશે, બીજું કંઈ વિચારશે નહીં. ડુ નોટ સ્ટ્રેન ઓર ટ્રાય ટુ વિલ ઇટ ઇન ટુ બીંગ. બી વેરી રિલેક્સ્ડ. જસ્ટ કીપ ધ ઇમેજ ઇન ધ માઇન્ડ, થિંકિંગ ઓફ ઇટ ઓબ્જેક્ટિવલી એઝ ઓફન એઝ યુ કેન, એઝ યોર એક્ટિવિટીઝ પરમિટ. Let not the objective mind do what properly belongs to the subjective mind. ખાલી એને યાદ કરવાનું છે objective mind. ચિત્ર બનાવવાનું નથી. The objective mind does not have to change the picture or do anything with the picture. It is just remembering and holding, remembering and holding. These images are thought forms because they are real forms in the world of thought. એટલે in this outside world of furniture and things are real, in the inner world thoughts are real, and this thought form is a real thing in the inner world of thought. એટલે જેમ બહારની દુનિયામાં furniture અને વસ્તુઓ real છે, એમ અંદરની દુનિયામાં વિચારો real છે, furniture ની જેમ જ છે. એટલે આ વસ્તુ આપણે યાદ કર્યા કરીએ છીએ તો વિચારોની દુનિયામાં એ ઉત્પન્ન થઈ જાય છે. ત્યાં ટોક ટુ યોર સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ એઝ ધો ઇટ વર ડાયરેક્ટલી ટુ અન ઇન્ડિવિજ્યુઅલ. ધ સોલર પ્લેક્સસ ઇઝ ધ સેન્ટર ઓફ યોર સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ એન્ડ ઇઝ ધ ઇન્ડિવિજ્યુઅલ્સ લિંક વિથ ધ યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડ. એટલે કહે છે કે હવે તમારું જે સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ છે એની સાથે વાત કરજો. એની જગ્યા ક્યાં છે? અહીંયા સોલર પ્લેક્સસમાં. એક એક્સરસાઇઝ અમને કરાવતા, વી હેવ ટુ ટોક વિથ ધી ઓર્ગન્સ ઓફ ધ બોડી, રાઈટ? વિચ આઈ હેવ ફોરગોટન, બટ વી હેડ ટુ ડુ ઇટ ઇન ધોઝ ડેઝ. એટલે વી વુડ હેવ ટુ પિક્ચરાઇઝ આર લિવર એન્ડ ટોક ટુ ધ લિવર કે યુ વિલ ફંક્શન બેટર. Today we will imprint and then we will talk to each organ of the body, and that exercise I remember now practicing for 6 months, right? So we had to practice this exercise. So just visualize your subjective mind here and let the objective mind talk to it, that please use your power to make this a reality, what you want. When you speak to your subjective mind, close your eyes, simply so that your objective mind may not be diverted. એટલે મન સ્થિર રહે એટલે આંખ બંધ કરો. In the darkness of closed eyes, try to feel the subtle body of the universal mind flowing through your organism. Bring yourself first to this definite feeling. Okay. This is very good. But I don't remember all this. I just wrote in one note here. First, subjective mind told universal mind. Right? Then, subjective mind gave the work to the objective mind. Objective mind is fulfilling its duty and it has to be one-pointed. Now objective mind is talking to subjective mind. Can you see the whole reciprocal process? The whole reciprocal process, right? એટલે પહેલા subjective mind ને universal mind ની અંદર છાપ મૂકી દીધી. પછી subjective mind ને એને યાદ કરવા માટેનું કામ કોને સોંપ્યું? Objective mind. પછી એને કીધું કે આ જગ્યા છે સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ નું. હવે ઓબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ એ કહે છે કે તમે સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ સાથે વાત કરો. ટોક ટુ ધ સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ એન્ડ ક્લોઝ યોર આઈઝ એન્ડ ટોક ટુ ધ સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ સો ધેટ યુ આર નોટ ડાયવર્ટેડ એનીવેર. નાઉ હી સે વેન યુ આર ટોકિંગ ટુ ધ સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ બ્રિંગ અ ડેફિનેટ ફીલિંગ. અ ડેફિનેટ ફીલિંગ. વોટ ઇઝ ધ ફીલિંગ? Every moment the universal mind is flowing through you. એટલે કહે છે કે હવે ઓબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ જ્યારે સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ સાથે વાત કરે છે ત્યારે અંદર એક સંવેદના કરજો કે ધ યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડ, એક મહાનદી ઓફ ધ યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડ, અ હ્યુજ રિવર ઓફ ધ યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડ ઇઝ ફ્લોઈંગ થ્રુ યુ એન્ડ ઇટ બિકમ્સ ધ સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ એટ ધીસ પોઈન્ટ. આ જગ્યાએ સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ બને છે. Bring yourself first to this definite, then with your eyes closed, bring the picture of your thought form to the subjective mind, describing clearly to the subjective mind, which you conceive of as the solar plexus. Subjective mind impresses the image with which it is charged upon the whole body of the universal mind. Aam thi aam aayega ne aam thi aam. Pachu view it. When it came this way, it goes back this way. It becomes a circle. Right? So the objective mind now tells the subjective mind, this is the picture. This is exactly what the picture is. The subjective mind takes that picture and in this river of the universal mind, it puts in the picture saying that this is the picture which I want. Jem apne tarpan kariye koi. એના અસ્થિ લઈને આપણે નદીમાં મૂકીએ એવી રીતે ધીસ પિક્ચર ફર્સ્ટ ધ ઓબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ ડિસ્ક્રાઇબ્સ ટુ ધ સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ. એક્ચ્યુઅલી ધ સબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ હઝ ઓન્લી ક્રિએટેડ ધ પિક્ચર, રાઈટ? એન્ડ ગિવન ઇટ ટુ ધ ઓબ્જેક્ટિવ માઇન્ડ વિચ ઇઝ મેડ ડેફિનેટ, રાઈટ? અને નાઉ ઇટ ગોઝ બેક, ગિવ્સ ધ ડેફિનેટ પિક્ચર The subjective mind takes that picture and then universal mind, the other, he does tarpan, he gives that picture to the universal mind. Okay, I leave it to you. I give it back to you. Then with closed eyes, bring the picture of your thought form to the mind and describe it clearly to your subjective mind, which you conceive as the solar plexus in our visualized project. Subjective mind impinges the image with it, which it is charged upon the whole body of the universal mind. It just gives it, this is it, to the whole flow of the river. The clearer and simpler your presentation, the quicker will you attain results. Just give the plain outlines of what you want to realize. Jetlu tamaru saral hase vastu, jetlu jaldi tame aa vastu kari sako without thought coming in between, this whole process, etlu jaldi tame e vastu ne meli sakso. Do not limit the subjective mind as to time. Time no bandharan nahi aapka, ki I want it in 6 months or in 3 months or whatever. Do not stipulate how or through what channels it can come to you. Yani kehta nahi ki aap vyakti hai mane aapko jo ek aur it should come from here or it should come from grandfather or grandmother or whatever. Do not worry about the results. Chinta nahi karta. Do not, you have tarpan kari, you have given it. Now that is the end. After koi ko tarpan kari, whenever we do take somebody's ashes, the symbolic is now you are on your own journey. Whatever connection was there between you and me is over. We lived together for so much time. We enjoyed each other's company. Everything was fine. Now you go your way. And that's the end of the matter. That's called tarpan. Right? So similarly, once you have given it to the universal mind, do not worry where it is going to come. Just drop it. Formations in the invisible worlds seek manifestation in the visible world. Age vastu andar ni sukshma dunya ma baneli chhe. That thing which is made in the inner subtle world, it has its own desire. Any other ichha padeli chhe. From a subtle sukshma ma ki mare sthul banu chhe. I want to become a gross thing in the physical world. The seed is the thought form. Make sure it is the one you want. It must be free from all disturbances. See that there are no disturbances. If you worry about it, then you are disturbing it. Don't disturb it in any way. You have now given it. Stamp the thought form in the universal mind carefully and earnestly. Then just as you do not disturb the seed after planting, you do not disturb the thought form by doubting its power. Do not doubt or by fussing with details. Please do not fuss because it already knows beforehand. Even before we can ask, it knows what we are going to ask. It already knows beforehand. There is no point in fussing over details. Right? Jini jini vastu upar bahu नानी नानी वाली नहीं करता बाकी हाँ वस्तु बगड़ी जैसे. Now he has brought a quotation of Christ. Therefore I say unto you, whatsoever things ye desire, when ye pray, believe that ye receive them, and ye shall receive them. Christ के तमें जा रहे प्रार्थना करो जो तमें जे कहीं मांग सो तमने बड़ी जैसे. With the infinite and the eternal, to know and to act are one and the same. એટલે અંદરની દુનિયામાં ઇન ધી ઇનર માઇન્ડ ઇન ધી ઇન્ફિનિટ માઇન્ડ ધી યુનિવર્સલ માઇન્ડ ધ મિનિટ ઇટ ઇઝ ઓલરેડી નોન ઓવર ધેર ધ નોઇંગ એન્ડ એક્શન આર વન થિંગ ઇટ હેઝ ટુ હેપન. નેચર વેસ્ટ નથિંગ. ઇફ યુ હેડ નોટ અર્ન ધ રાઇટ ટુ નો અબાઉટ થોટ ફોર્મ્સ યુ વુડ નોટ હિયર. સો હી સેઇંગ નેચર વેસ્ટ નથિંગ. જો તમારા નસીબમાં આ વસ્તુ સાંભળવાનું ન હોત તો તમે સાંભળી શકત જ નહીં, પણ એ તમારા નસીબમાં છે. ઇટ ઇઝ ઇન યોર ડેસ્ટિની ટુ હિયર ધીસ, એન્ડ ધેટ ઇઝ વાય ઇટ હેઝ કમ ટુ યુ. રાઈટ? ઇફ યોર પાસ્ટ હેઝ નોટ બ્રોટ યુ ટુ ધીસ પોઈન્ટ, તમારા જૂના સંસ્કાર તમને અહીં સુધી લઈ આવ્યા છે. યોર પાસ્ટ, ઓલ યોર ઓલ્ડ વોટ એવર હેપનિંગ્સ હેવ બ્રોટ યુ ટુ ધીસ પોઈન્ટ. વેધર યુ એક્સેપ્ટ ધીસ ગ્રેટ પાવર એન્ડ યુઝ ઇટ, યુ ટુ ધીસ પોઈન્ટ વેર યુ કુડ એક્સેપ્ટ ધીસ ગ્રેટ પાવર એન્ડ યુઝ ઇટ, યુ વુડ નોટ બી ટોલ્ડ અબાઉટ ઇટ. એટલે ઇફ યુ આર નોટ ડિઝર્વિંગ ટુ હિયર અબાઉટ ધીસ, ધીસ વુડ નોટ હેવ બી ટોલ્ડ ટુ યુ. તમે જો આની માટે લાયક ન હો તો આ વસ્તુ તમને મળવા ન હોય. બટ બી શ્યોર દેટ યોર થોટ ફોર્મ્સ ડુ નોટ ઇન્ટેન્ડ હાર્મ ટુ અનધર. જે કંઈ તમે વિચારો, તમારા વિચારોની અંદર કોઈ બીજા પ્રત્યે હાનિ ન થાય. ક્લિયર આઉટ યોર હાર્ટ એની બિટર, ડિસ્ટ્રક્ટિવ, અનકાઇન્ડ, અનચેરિટેબલ ફિલિંગ્સ. યુ કેનોટ બિલ્ડ અ ન્યુ હાઉસ વિથ રબિશ ફ્રોમ ધી ઓલ્ડ વન. એટલે હૃદયની અંદર કોઈના પ્રત્યે ગાંઠ છે, કોઈનું નુકસાન કરવાનું છે, કોઈના પ્રત્યે અણગમો છે, અનચેરિટેબલ ફિલિંગ્સ, તો એ બધું કાઢી નાખો. નવું ઘર જૂનો કચરોમાંથી નથી બની શકતું. વર્ક ફર્સ્ટ ઓન યોર બેઝિક થોટ ફોર્મ. જે અંદર જે થોટ ફોર્મ તમે, મેક ઇટ પાવરફુલ. નેવર માઇન્ડ ધ સ્પેસિફિક વોન્ટ ઇન યોર લાઈફ that needs to be fulfilled. Je tumne specific joye chhe, exact joye chhe, ehi bo chinta nahi kare. That will be taken care of more quickly if you first make sure of your general alignment with nature's constructive forces. Andar je this whole universal mind flowing through us, try to align yourself with that. Don't go into details of what. If you are aligned with that, then every moment it will give you what you want. Just bring yourself into alignment with the universal mind flowing through you. Visualize the thought form and constantly in full faith that your thought form is working out. In vari gadi yaad karjo, visualize karjo, ane andar what you call faith, itle trust, shraddha rakhjo ki e vastu bani rahyu chhe, it is being worked out. In the factory, the thing is being made. Doubt is a mild form of expressing something stronger and more dangerous. Jo andar shanka aavi gayi, doubt aavi gayi, something doubt comes in, then later on something more dangerous will come. Then you will start doubting and it will never happen. Our doubts are our traitors. Doubt aapi ek nabraai chhe, traitors. Never forget to give thanks. Always say thank you, be thankful. I thank thee, Father, that thou hast heard me. એટલે આખી process, when you have finished this process, say thank you that you have heard. Say thank you to the universal mind that you have heard me. તે મને સાંભળ્યો. What is worth having is worthy of thanks. જે કંઈ જીવનમાં worthy છે મેળવવા માટે એ થેન્ક યુ કહેવા માટે પણ વર્ધી છે. યોર લાઈફ કેન બી જસ્ટ એઝ વન્ડરફુલ એઝ યુ ડિસાઈડ ટુ મેક ઇટ. યોર વરીઝ, ડિસ્ટ્રેસ, સફરિંગ ઓર પ્રોબ્લેમ્સ મે બી ધ ગોલગોથા દેટ ઇઝ ઇન્ટેન્ટેડ ટુ હાર્મ યોર ઇનર કોન્શિયસનેસ ટુવર્ડ્સ ધ લાઈટ, ટુવર્ડ્સ ધ સન. ધીસ ઇઝ ગુડ, બટ ટુ ટર્ન ટુવર્ડ્સ લાઈટ વેન થિંગ્સ વિલ ગો વેલ ઇઝ બેટર. એટલે કદાચ આપણા જીવનમાં એવું હોય કે જ્યારે આપણે દુઃખી છીએ, તકલીફમાં છીએ, ત્યારે આપણે અંદરની તરફ યાત્રા કરીએ. પણ એ કે જ્યારે બધું સારું હોય ત્યારે પણ અંદર તરફ યાત્રા કરજો. સો યુ સે ડોન્ટ જસ્ટ મૂવ ઇન વેન યુ આર ઇન મિઝરી એન્ડ ઇન પેઇન, મૂવ ઇન વેન યુ આર ઇન ગુડ ટાઈમ્સ ટુ. નાઉ ધીસ ટેકન અ કોટેશન ફ્રોમ ધ પોએટ જ્હોન બરોઝ. The sage attends to the inner, not the outer. જે ઋષિ છે એ અંદરનું કરે છે, બહારનું નહીં. અંદર થોટ ફોર્મ કરી લીધું, એ બહાર વ્યક્ત જ થવાનું છે. He has made the thought form inside. It has to come outside. Serene, I fold my hands and wait. મનમાં શાંતિ, serene, at peace in the mind. I fold my hands, હાથ જોડીને હું પ્રતીક્ષા કરું છું. I wait. Nor care for weight, nor tide, nor sea. Man ni andar whatever comes, different thoughts will come, tidal waves will come, whatever comes in the mind, don't bother about it. Just wait. I rave no more against time or fate. Never curse your own destiny. Many times people, they curse their destiny. Maru nasib aj phutelu che. Maru nasib aj phutelu, maru nasib aj aavu che. Never, he's saying, never do that. Never do that. For lo, my own shall come to me. Ke je maru che, to mane marva aavanu che. What is written in my spectrum will come to me. It has to come to me. I stay my haste, I make delays. Utavar nahi karta, stay my haste, I make delays. And jo, if it takes a long time, jo, delay thai, to just be patient. For what avails this eager pace? Utavar thi su bhaiyuj. Nothing in life, nobody has ever got anything from haste. I stand amid the eternal waves. If you have aligned yourself with the universal mind, the river of the universal mind, meeting with the subjective mind with the objective mind, so you're standing in between where all this is meeting together, you're standing there. Eternal waves. Ane aa sadiyoti chalich aave che, it goes on and on. The stars come nightly to the sky. Roj raate tarao aave che, the stars come every night. The tidal wave comes to the sea. Moktu moju darya maavish, tidal wave. Neither time nor space, nor deep nor high, can keep my own way from me. Samay, space, unnaan ke ochaan, jevu par tidal wave hoye, je maru che ene koe, roki saktu, nothing can keep what is mine from me. The universal mind can and does operate through all human individual minds. Our universal mind, harek individual vyaktigat man mati kaam kareche. The universal mind is going to do a lot for you. What are you going to do to serve the purpose of the universal mind? Chhele ki mukhe che ke e je universal mind tamara mate to khub karse par tame eni mate su so, right? Okay, so this just one paper, a note of his. So, your question answer.
Right? No, that's in the process of this creation that you're talking about.
Right.
You know, you said once you plant the seed, you might just sort of forget about it. But surely you still
don't worry about it, don't forget. You have to keep on remembering.
Yeah, okay. So you must water the seed.
You must water the seed. But you don't worry about it.
I just want to do that.
Remember. That is why I said in the objective mind, whenever in the day you can just remember your picture. And again drop it. Again you remember your picture. Hold it for some time.
Okay. And what if you ask for something harmful? I mean, didn't Hitler, I feel that Hitler had quite a conscience that he could actually manifest something there. That you wanted, yes. Although it was harmful.
Yes, but it can become very destructive. It can become very destructive. And we don't know which forces were working behind Hitler. And it is possible that, say, a whole packet of energy was given to Hitler. And it may have been given by some conscious masters. And Hitler had a advisor whose name was Horshoffer. And the packet of energy was supposed to work through a symbol, which was called the swastika. And Horshoffer turned the swastika wrong way around. And so that which was given to him to bring constructive, this thing, it became destructive, and it destroyed him also. So there is no way you can ask for some destruction.
What do you mean you can't ask? Because indeed, it happened to Hitler.
It did happen, but for Hitler to again dissolve all that crystallized negativity will take at least 1,000 lifetimes. He dissolves all that. Then he can start from ABC again. Can you see? Because once it has become cement concrete inside, then you have to break all that pattern, all those patterns inside. So
for your own conscious development, one should not ask for that. Because the universal mind is...
Ask for what is in alignment with the forces of nature. You want to grow in consciousness, ask for it. To grow in consciousness, you want comfort, ask for comfort. You want a little bit of material joy, ask for it. But don't ask for something which is going to lead you into deeper states of identification. Right? Then it will have a reverse effect. What we try to do is, if someone can put these steps down into, you know, the steps he has written, right, from starting with the subjective mind, the universal mind, the objective mind, and the objective mind again talking to the subjective mind again putting that whole feedback, reciprocal process. I think if we can put down those steps in a proper way, it'll be easier for everyone.
Yes.
So,
yes.
We can do that. Yes.
Swastika. Somebody asked me, what is the meaning of a swastika, especially if you say that they reversed it and it caused destruction instead of good. What is the true meaning of a swastika?
It is energy going in the direction of consciousness. Right? So, supposing you put a swastika in your home, right? So the idea of that swastika is that this home you will use only for positive purposes. That swastika is a reminder. Okay, this is your energy wants to flow in a certain direction, and it is always clockwise. If you see, the swastika is always clockwise. Hitler's swastika was anti-clockwise. That is why we are always very careful never to draw a swastika on a transparent object like glass. Because if somebody sees it from the other side, then it becomes reverse. We always draw a swastika only on an opaque object. Because there is no other side to that swastika. You get what I'm trying to say? So you have to be very careful. And I used to know one lady who used to do black magic with reverse swastika, that she was very powerful and she could create a lot of disturbance. Right? And I've seen her doing all that. So don't ever draw a swastika on a glass or something like that. People, they make, you know, those tainted, have you seen those tainted glasses, you know, and they draw swastikas. They don't realize what they're doing. They don't realize what they're doing. So it is always a motion towards consciousness. That is why even in your home, whenever you design your home, you try to always visualize everything in the motion of the swastika. You won't have a staircase which is going in the opposite direction. Right. Now if you have one, it is okay. Put a mirror in front of it. But what I am trying to say is, you see, you try to have everything in the direction of the swastika. So when you are looking at the flow of energy in your home, you are always, it should be in that direction of the swastika. That is the swastika.
And the four dots that we make, what are they?
They are the four directions. The four directions. Yes, sir.
You talk of the universal mind,
right,
and the subjective mind. The one is constrained by time and space, right?
Right.
The other is the truth. Is that
right? Right.
Rajen Bhai, you were saying you want to make an impression on the universal mind you gave today, but is this the same what you said a week ago where you said if you're asking for something...
Then I just give you some breathing techniques.
Yeah, a dying declaration and breathe out completely. Yeah, is this the same as...
Same thing.
Okay.
Towards the end, could you mention that you... What are you doing to help the universal mind? So, what should we do?
See, always think of things in abundance. Right? Supposing I am making a shop, so my objective is profit. right? But also I think of how many more can I employ? At a basic level, this, you see, what is my aim? So, supposing suddenly I come into a lot of money, then how can I use that money rightly? So, that is one thing. And the second thing is, of course, that if I experience a little higher level of consciousness, then can I catch somebody's hand to lift him up to that level?
Does one have the right to do?
Huh?
So does one have the right to do
that? Yes, because that is why Buddha said, Buddham Sangham Sharanam Gacchami. That the one who has gone one step ahead, he pulls one person up. And the person ahead pulls one person up.
Someone's working for you, your char or your secretary or whoever works for you, you help them and you raise them.
When you are talking about help, you are talking about, you know, physical help and things like that. What I am talking about is for their inner journey. You put in something at the right time, okay, would you like to, you know. So that is to help in consciousness. Now there is something deeper in this. Much deeper. That is the whole significance of the Gayatri Mantra. That each moment creation is coming out of the mother's womb. It is not something which has happened. It is happening every moment. Happening every moment. So, every moment the mother is giving birth to the universe. And that is what we, that is the feeling of the Gayatri as the mother. Gayatri as the mother. And because she is giving birth to you, there is a conscious suffering involved, there is the labor pain involved. So, to take part consciously in that labor pain. Now this is very little difficult to understand. But to take upon yourself as conscious suffering. Suffering for consciousness. Suffering for consciousness. So that would mean that at some time in your life you will realize that the universal mind wants this and I personally want this. Can you keep your personally on the side and work for the universal mind? So then you are suffering for the mother, for Gayatri. For Gayatri. You are putting your personal, this thing, and in that person you are sacrificing, so there is a suffering. And in that suffering you are taking her suffering. Yeah? When you are doing it for her. So, I am trying to explain it in a certain way, but this is what he is trying to do. So that is the essence of the Gayatri Mantra. That you are suffering, but give me also a part of that suffering. You are suffering, because labor is suffering. It is joy also, but it is also pain. So give me a part of that. Right? And that is creativity. So swastika is also pure creativity. Pure creativity.
So the second line, Rupam Sharanam Gacchami, then it's Gandham Sharanam Gacchami.
Sandham Sharanam. Sangha. So work on self, work with others. And Dharmam Sharanam Gacchami. Work for the work. What was the aim of the work? Now that requires a different kind of intelligence, because when the work comes from the guru, it comes with his personality. You see, when he is saying this, this has come out of his personality. Right? So when I have to give it to you, I have to remain authentic, not to my guru, to the teaching. Can you understand? This is a very difficult thing for a disciple, because he is always, authentic to the guru. But he has to be authentic to the teaching. To the teaching. Dharmam Sharanam Gacchami. Right? The guru had a personality. And that personality overpowers the teaching, because the presence of the guru, his power. You see? And then you have to separate the teaching from his power. So here, whatever his personal thing was, that was his personal life, comes with his personal body. Right? You may have loved it, you may have whatever, but when you are teaching, you don't allow any of that to come into the teaching. The teaching remains separate. So that is the final thing which the disciple does. He separates the teaching from the guru. So first he goes to the guru, buddham sharanam gacchami. Then when he learns a little, he works with others. And then the final act, he separates the dharma from the buddha. So the Buddha way, you see, like my guru did not want an ashram. Right? But supposing at some time I may have felt the need that the teaching needs a place where people can gather. So I may have made an ashram. Now that is going against the guru, but it is going for the teaching. And that is those become very painful decisions for the disciple, but he has to do it. Can you understand now what I'm trying to say? He has to separate the teaching from the personal this thing of the guru. The personal ideas of the Guru. Even though the teaching has come from the Guru.
How can you do that?
It has to be done. And that is conscious suffering. It's conscious suffering. Yes?
Some days ago you told a story which answered part of a question that I had for some time. You related a story about your father and his characteristics and a particular experience that he had which changed his direction
in
terms of the kind of person he was. Now, I was thinking about it and I'm thinking, how many of us or people in the world will come upon an experience like that which will change our direction in life and the kind of person that we are?
That was a very intense experience. So everyone may not come upon an experience of such intensity. Right? But that doesn't change anything. I was just talking about the magnetic center. The very fact that you and I have met is the magnetic center. It doesn't have to be such a miraculous experience. I was just trying to give you an idea of the power of the magnetic center. It can bring about overnight change, and some people it may not. And it's not necessary, because many times these overnight changes bring a lot of imbalance also. So we don't want an overnight change. I just wanted to give you an example of the intensity of the magnetic center. That a person who was totally against all this, but when the magnetic center opens, overnight the direction of life can change. But the very fact that we have come together is our magnetic centers have brought us together. And nothing goes to waste, you know. Nothing goes to waste. I mean, people may not work upon it, but still somewhere the words go. So, thank you. Jai Shri Krishna. We meet after 15 days.